hustling ahead, fires, and it's juggled and finally gathered in by Martin Gerber.
Now, that's a smart play by Jason Weimer in his own zone, because all he did was, instead of trying to make a perfect pass, he throws the puck to an area. Watch him just throw it to an area, knowing that there's the defenseman had come over, the player had come over, that there was an opening over there, and that allowed Mark Parrish just to walk into it and get the shot. It seemed to dip a little bit, but Gerber able to handle it.
Yashin thrown out of a faceoff. Ruchin ends up beating Kavasha to the draw. Linesman kept that puck from skittering down ice, but now it's brought in by the Ducks. Ruchin a soft backhander. DiPietro turned it aside. Rospel gets it back. Centering feed dribbles to DiPietro as Alexei Smirnov, number 22, had a great chance, and he got more of that puck. This would be a 1-0 game.
Yeah, well, Kavasha lost the puck. He'll lose the puck right there, and then when he comes back the other way, he missed kicking it, and DiPietro, with an athletic move, reaches over and lets go of the stick, and then just reaches over and grabs it with his other hand just before that puck was ready to roll in. Good play by Crosswell to lift the stick of Kavasha and get the chance.
Each team with one shot here in the early going, just a little more than 4 minutes gone in the first period. Sean Bates in over the line, looks for Blake, but he was too well covered, and Gerber holds on.
Now that puck that Gerber just scooped up was on the ice. Can't score on Gerber on the ice, even though that was a pass. In fact, his teammates have a difficult time scoring on him in practice on the ice, and there's J.S. Chiguer, who signed a 4-year, $20 million contract just prior to the season.
That wasn't Chiguer, that was Dick Butkus. Off the inboard, Blake scores! It came right to Blake on a hard carom. And Jason Blake, we showed you just moments ago, he's got it going again. And he puts the Islanders on top, 1-0.
Well, this was quick, right off the faceoff. Blake was on the board. This is a set play by Blake. He just tries to jam it in right off the goaltender in hopes that he's not set yet. And Chiguer had to leave the net first, come out, cut down the angle, then get back. So he was moving on the play. And that was not a lucky goal. That was a goal that Blake tried to score from behind the net, and it worked.
So Jason Blake gives the Islanders the lead for Blake, his fourth goal of the year.
He's starting to get hot, isn't he? He's starting to get going. I mean, he had all kinds of chances against Pittsburgh. He's starting to find open ice again. Remember, Gerber, goes off the skate first of Soleil. And that might have thrown Gerber off a little bit. Probably did, because Gerber was coming out to make the save. When the puck ricocheted off the skate of Soleil, 24, then it took the hop off the boards of Blake.
Roman Hamrlich shoots one wide of Gerber. One of the best of the whole bunch, our pal Lorne Henning.
He's something, isn't he? Terrific, terrific guy. Synonymous with Stanley Cups here in Long Island. And now in his second year as an assistant coach at Anaheim.
As one daughter finishing out high school here on Long Island, thinking about colleges. Of course, there are some nice warm weather schools out west that one might be able to convince his daughter to attend.
And he has his son, who's a recent graduate from Notre Dame University.
Right. Tough guy Dan Bylsma out of the lineup as well for Anaheim. He had right knee surgery. Here's Kavasha powering ahead. Put it behind Cherkovsky. Took a hit. Cherkovsky's there for the puck, but he got tied up. Paulson trying to clear. And finally, the Ducks do. Smirnov had the stick knocked right out of his hand.
And Howie, they missed LeClair. They really missed LeClair. He's as close to a power forward as they have.
Yashin, a shot. He hit the post. Good, quick wrist shot by Alexei Yashin. Now Yashin again for Kavasha. Slips it in front. Cherkovsky tied up, put it right through the slot. Only Smirnov was there. And the Ducks race to center. The puck behind Smirnov. Banks it back off the wall looking for Prospel. And then Steve Ruchin, number 20, puts it behind the Islander goal. 5:42 to go in the first.
Pardon me, Howie. Back-to-back good shifts by the Islanders. First one was the Blake line that came out. Blake with Bates and Hunter, and then it's followed up.
And that line's back out there now, the Bates line. Bates goes wide, feeds Hunter, quick shot, went wide.
That one deflected off of Havilid, the defenseman, and then just wide.
The last few games Trent Hunter has dressed, he has looked like a completely different player from that which we saw in basically cameo appearances the last year or so. He's got a little more grit to his game, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Centering feed deflects. Blake's got it back. Now Hunter looking for Bates. We know Hunter's got good hands, goal scorer's hands.
Well, you know what he has to do, and he knows this. He has to come out and play physical every game, take the man, not try and necessarily hurt somebody, but just play that type of game where you finish your check. And he's worked extremely hard to stay in this lineup and deserves more ice time, which he's getting.
4:40 remaining in the opening period. Mecca intercepts a pass, puts it right back in. There's going to be a penalty here, though, to the Ducks. Interference, the call. Islander power play when we get back.
Up high, off the post, and out the other way.
The action excused from a faceoff, so Cavasso wins it, and the Islanders put the power play to work. Nenemo with O'Coin, the point man. Yashin's line up front. Burkovsky surrounded, but O'Coin backs the play up. Arias for Yashin. Now to Cavasso. He shoots, and he went wide. Great chance for Oleg Cavasso.
I think Soleil came over and rushed that back. Might have got his stick on Kabashi's stick as he was shooting.
Fedorov sends it out of the zone.
Boy, this line's got, they've really got something going, don't they? Right, they seem to be reading off of one another. They're making passes without having to look, just knowing where the other line mate is.
Really interesting, because when Tchaikovsky and Yashin played together 2 years ago, they didn't have that kind of chemistry.
Yeah, you know what? I think both players are working harder. I really do. I mean, Tchaikovsky knows that this is his last chance, or at least feels that way. And he's trying to take advantage of that by working and getting to the openings and communicating.
Nice moves by Kavasha.
And that's the other key right there, Kavasha being on the line.
He's working too.
Yep.
Tchaikovsky to Kavasha, score!
With a 2-0 lead.
Somebody's just got to calm Ole down after he scores a goal.
He just gets too excited, doesn't
he? Yeah. Sikora looking short side. DiPietro stopped it. But Ole Kavasha had a great chance earlier in the power play. Converts that one. And for Kavasha, his third of the year. 2-0 New York. 3 minutes to go here in the first period. Out comes Martinek. On right wing, Hunter. Blake to the net. And Blake goes crashing into the goaltender. Now, did Havlat send him there or not? Gerber, slow to get up. We'll see about a penalty when we get back.
Watch him cut into the net. And there you see. He has to make that save early on a puck that was kind of dropping on the shot by Parrish. And Rick DiPietro has to be alert in goal as he stops a puck that deflects and rolls towards the net. Then off the faceoff, something the Islanders didn't win a lot of, but they won that one. That was important as Blake takes advantage of a deflected puck and puts it in past Gerber. That makes it 1-0. Yashin had a chance that goes off the post and out the other way. And the Islanders did a good job getting the loose pucks and moving the puck around. That shot by Kavasha just went wide on the Yashin setup. And then Yashin again moves the puck. Hammerlick quickly to one side. Tchaikovsky and the power play goals. Kavasha finishes things off. That made it a 2-0 lead for the Islanders.
Gorgeous. Just as it reads. Kavasha from Tchaikovsky and Hammerlick. Pinpoint pass.
Well-deserved honor for Pat LaFontaine.
Brent
Hunter looks like he could play, doesn't he?
Saw him just before the season started. He's got a million different things going on now between all of his charitable endeavors and honeydew work around the house.
Building a big home on Long Island and got some other things going on and trying to fit in a little golf now and then.
Well, congratulations to Pat LaFontaine.
Absolutely.
Who goes into the Hall of Fame on Monday. Second year in a row that the great Islander has gone into the Hall. Last year it was Clark Gillies. Carney intercepts for Anaheim and sends it in. Slapped around the boards by Kenny Johnson. Comes right back to him. And now Hunter works it ahead. Carney intercepted. McDonald offside at the Islander line. Our Islanders hockey moment, as long as we're on the subject of Monsieur LaFontaine, is brought to you by Mohegan Sun. Enjoy the memories of what is a Hall of Fame career. It all started here on the island.
There's one of his lucky goals that he scored.
What did he score his last year in juniors with that Compte? Were like 236 goals or something.
Some guys
like that.
That are just lucky, you know? I mean, how did he split two defensemen like that, pull the puck to his skates, take his time, be patient, wait for the goaltender to go down, and then put it in the empty net?
They were all sleeping. They're all sleeping.
Fluky goal.
Sikora behind the net for Anaheim. Cairns got a good chunk of him, and part of Cheestoff as well. Cheestoff just slapped the stick out of Cairns' hands, and Cheestoff's going to get a penalty.
Now, the one thing that's been a constant in this game regarding the referees is that they have called everything that has come close to being an interference call or a hooking call. And we've seen calls where players have just brushed against other players to try and slow them down, make them take a longer route. They've been called. And this time, Cairns, who lost his stick on the play, draws the penalty. So the Islanders with the opportunity here on the power play. They've already scored a power play goal in this game.
And the Islanders put Pekka between Weimer and Parrish. And on the points, O'Coin. And across now, Yanni Ninema. His lead for Parrish offside.
I think Weimer was offside on the right side. Weimer, I think, thought the puck was going in, and Parrish reached up with his glove and grabbed it down. Here's Weimer over here. I think it might have been Peck on the other side as well, who had his back to the play. A good play by Parrish to knock it down.
O'Coin's pass picked off by Ruchin. So DiPietro's got to play the puck. 20 seconds gone on the Islander power play. Pekka. And now Parrish in pursuit. That hopped over Weimer's stick, but O'Coin's ready for it. Now Pekka. Austin Ninema. One-timer O'Coin. It's tip kick save made by Gerber, who finally holds on despite a scramble that saw Weimer get dumped.
As we take a look at our Panasonic digital replay, the shot by O'Coin was low. He took it right off the pass. Right here, and it'll hit a skate on the way. There's one deflection, hit a stick, actually, of Niedermeyer. Then it deflected again, I believe, by Weimer or Parrish in front before Gerber is able to cover up. One save, two saves. Parrish keeps digging for it, and Weimer getting some power play time. Coach Steve Sterling trying to get his offense going.
Now Yashin goes to the corner. Islanders made a good recovery after Fedorov. Yashin dueled on a draw that Fedorov won. But now Soleil on the loose puck. And that was chopped down, and Fedorov had his stick up high. Well, we're going to get a penalty too, huh?
Yes, we are.
Interference penalty. I'm
telling you, everything, anytime a player is standing in front of another player and slows them down at all, these two referees are making the calls. I mean, now if you're the players on both sides, you've got to be able to recognize that and just stay away from it. Now watch what happens right there. Yashin.
I mean, it's
a little bit of a pick.
2 minutes for interference.
The
Islanders number 12, Kavasha, 2 minutes interference.
That was Kavasha.
Well, Kavasha and Cheestov now in the box. It's 4-on-4. And then in 50 seconds, Anaheim will have a power play for about a minute. So a little open ice here. Ozilinch.
I think he got the wrong guy, Howie. I think he meant to call it on Yashin and thought it was Kavasha.
There's a 2-on-1 developing. Cherkovsky with Yashin. Cherkovsky closes in, feeds Yashin, he shoots, and he scores! And the Islanders take a 3-0 lead.
Yashin on the backhand. And Yashin just put everything into it, put it right through Gerber. Right through him. He got the shot off quick before Gerber could really get set. He gets a piece of it, but not all of it. Big goal for Alexei Yashin. Well, I thought should have been in the penalty box, and now the benefit that he wasn't, and he scores the goal.
Second game in a row that Alexei Yashin has scored, and they're getting jiggy.
Yeah, remember we told you were going to play in Chicago tomorrow? We have a slight change in plan. You know, again, Howie, I think that they wanted to call the... I think that the original penalty, Kavasha had the puck, and he ends up getting the penalty. And now right here, we got Kavasha here, but there's the play, and there's a referee with the hand up. So see, he's got to look through the net over there, and the pick and the penalty should have been against Yashin, but it wasn't called against him. It was called against Kavasha. Yashin stays on the ice, ends up scoring a goal.
A big break for the Islanders.
And that's a great job by our guys on the truck to find that, find the referee over on the other side to notice that. And it turns out to be a break for the Islanders in a 3-0 game. Here's the play again, right there. You see, that was the call. And the referee was way over on the right-hand side. He made the interference call, but they put the wrong guy in the box. And the guy that the penalty was called on.
Ducks and Islanders. Martin Gerber between the pipes for the Ducks. The Isles strike early and often. The point shot goes wide of the net, but Jason Blake, he's there to bang it home. That makes it 1-0 Islanders. They make it 2-0 before the period is out. Some great passing. Marius Tcherkassky. The back of the net. 2-0 Isles after one. Then more New York. Tcherkassky making it happen again. This time he finds Alexei Yashin, who slips it in, and that is enough of Gerber. He gets the hook, and in comes J.S. Giguère. The Ducks get one back. Andy McDonald's point shot redirected by Peter Sikora. That cuts the lead to two. The Isles pad the lead in the third. Puck comes to Trent Hunter, and he makes no mistake. The Isles take it to the Ducks. 4-1 is how this game ends up. Martin Gerber allowing three goals on just 8 shots before being relieved by Giguère. His goals against average goes up from 1.38 to 182. The Isles penalty killers went 5-for-6 in this game. The Islanders are the best in the league shorthanded, killing 44 of 48 power plays.
Surface with 2:42 to go in the first period. Shots are 8-6 Ottawa.
Now Steve Sterling raved about the play of Jason Weimer against Anaheim, and they did a great job on the Fedorov line, holding them to just one shot. Now, Weimer reminds me, his personality reminds me of Garth Snow. Now, a very good teammate, doesn't complain when he doesn't play, just keeps his nose clean. When he does play, goes out, plays hard, will do anything for the team. And he and Snow are very similar in their personalities in that regard.
Yeah, he's had some games where he just did not get a whole lot of ice time. Neal with a shot. Elbowed away by DiPietro. Redden fires, and that's kicked out by DiPietro. Now behind the net, Rakunic lost it to Cairns. A couple of games ago, Weimer had just 3.5 minutes. That was the game at Pittsburgh, but back comes Yashin. He shoots, and he went wide on the glove side. Earl's hard around, and Ninema's got a scamper back for it.
No, that didn't miss by much. Rakunic, the defenseman, the right defenseman, was in deep in the Islanders' zone. He ended up behind the net, and the Islanders were able to get the puck free and start that 2-on-1.
Marish didn't hold it cleanly. Virata down the right wing. He shoots the side by DiPietro. Virata stays with it. Leaves it in the corner. Dug out by Hossa. Now to Phillips. Hossa banging his stick for the puck. The shot from Phillips. Rebounds to Chara. That one stopped by DiPietro and cleared by Janssen. And a race for an icing will be won by Chara with a minute 27 to go in the first.
And that was Chara that was in deep that time. That's the one thing about this Ottawa group of defense. They're able to join the rush, and it's almost become automatic. And Yashin, here's the 2-on-1. Watch Yashin. He'll just kind of look off the pass, and then he tries to beat Lalime to the far side. It just missed. Anyway, he's looking at Tcherkassky, but knows as the defenseman slides that he can't make the pass. He's got to take the shot and just missed.
Again, the Senators win an offensive zone draw. Chara let one go that fluttered past DiPietro, who was down and out of position.
And it looked like he caught his skate on the ice. as he was moving to his left. It looked like he just caught his skate and fell over.
And the Senators, meanwhile, continue to dominate the faceoffs in the Islanders' zone. They've won 9 out of 11 in that neighborhood. Bates over the line to Hunter. He fires. He scores!
Thursday, November 6th at 7 p.m. Get your tickets now.
Both teams in that first period came out and tried to establish a physical game. They're getting in the way, knocking players down. Everyone trying to establish themselves, and no one passed up an opportunity to run into somebody, including Astro didn't have a chance. That made it 1-0. The Islanders then started generating some offense of their own in the second half of that first period. Good chance here, but a great defensive play by Phillips on Alexei Yashin. And then eventually Trent Hunter, after the speed by Bates, a little drop pass, a hard shot just inside the far post, and Trent Hunter with his fourth of the season ties it for the Islanders.
So Hunter securing a spot for himself. Now the word on Jason Blake, he has a mild knee sprain, and he will be evaluated tomorrow. He will not, however, return in this game. This is how it happens.
That's not good news. Here it is again. The right leg of Alfredson. You can see Blake's right leg. Going to get jammed. He did come out for another shift, which was a positive sign. Skated on his own to the bench and then came out for about a 10-second shift to kill a penalty before heading to the locker room.
New York Islanders goal.
But he went right off. Right there, you knew something wasn't right. So 1-1 as we begin the second period. Islanders starting with the Pekka line, which now features Parrish and Weimer on the left wing. A whistle there for offside. Radek Bonk's unit out for Ottawa. So, let's take a look at tonight's Nissan trivia quiz. It has to do with Hall of Famer Pat LaFontaine, inducted tonight up in Toronto. That was a huge trade that Bill Torrey made with the Buffalo Sabres right around this time of the season, a dozen years ago. think about the big name. Actually, there were names who came back to the Islanders. That actually turned out to be a pretty good trade for New York, too. White centers that skipped past Alfredson. I mean, think about it now that they traded a Hall of Famer, but they got plenty back. Yanni Ninema behind the net. White for Alfredson, and he put it right through the goal mouth. Now Redden chops it to the corner. Ninema there for the Islanders, trying to turn away from Alfredson. O'Coin up the left wing. Gavasha with Yashin going to the net. Gavasha to Tchaikovsky. He scores! What a gorgeous play by Oleg Gavasha. And it's 2-1 New York.
And now, Howie, he made a play at the red line where he reached and redirected the puck to the outside to the board so that the defenseman Rakunin right there missed the puck. And then he just skated into it. What a pass. Woo! Through the legs of White onto the stick of Tchaikovsky. Woo! This line is almost unstoppable. Number 9 on the year for Tchaikovsky. What a play at the red line, or just prior to the red line by Kavasha. To make it look easy, Rakunin gets caught, the defenseman. And Ottawa seemed to have players back, and then the beautiful pass.
What a pass.
Wow.
I mean, Yashin was all by himself, headed right towards the net, right down the middle. Nobody had him. But Gavasha found the trailer, Tchaikovsky. Marius puts away his 9th goal of the year at the 55-second mark of the period. This reminds you of a little bit the Pittsburgh game, although DiPietro's got a scramble back. The Islanders gave one up late. Pittsburgh scored early in the next period. That's what's happening for the Islanders here.
DiPietro's hurt, just slowly getting up. Hamrlik ran into him behind the net. That's why he was late getting back into the play.
It's an offside pass to Havlat. Now let's take a look at DiPietro.
Still hurting a little bit. He went behind the net, and Hamrlik didn't see him, and Hamrlik ran right over him. And he slid about halfway to the corner and then tried to scramble back. There's Hamrlik. Boom. What a hit. And then he scrambles to get back and has to do this to try and keep the puck out of the net. Bates did a good job coming back to help out. And Hamrlik, he didn't have anywhere to go.
Well, DiPietro staying in his goal mouth,
where they handle the puck and they have so much confidence in their passing and trying to set up others. He says it's a difficult thing to get them to change. Not that he wants them to change, he just wants a few more shots out of both of those players.
Offside again, which is interesting about Yashin, because last year there was some criticism that Yashin would shoot the puck too much at the expense of passing it to a teammate.
And again, let's take a look at Tchaikovsky. I mean, here he is down here. Now watch what he does to get back into play. I mean, away he goes. He puts his head down and just takes off to the slot. And then he's right there. I mean, that's a great play by Tchaikovsky, just to put his head down and say, I got to get to a spot just in case I get the puck. So he hustled to that spot, and Kavasha gave him the perfect pass, and it was a perfect shot.
See, is DiPietro comfortable yet?
No, you know what? I saw him. He was kind of with his right arm and his shoulder, almost kind of, you know, lifting it up, trying to check it out. I'm still not sure that's the end. Yeah, you know, there he goes again.
Right shoulder, right?
Yeah.
Lead you to believe.
Got everything behind it. Great save by Patrick Lalinde.
And another face-off in the Ottawa zone. Janssen skips one wide. Follow away was Pekka. That shot was stopped, and Hossa comes ahead.
Pekka won that draw.
And just about every face-off this period has been in the Ottawa zone. 9 out of 10, in fact. Weimer fires. Scores! Lead it 3-1.
Yeah, that was a turnover at the Islanders' blue line. And when Weimer ended up with the puck, I think he surprised everybody. There's the turnover. Parrish did the job knocking it down. Weimer, watch him, just with a quick shot.
Woo!
And right through the pads of Patrick Lalinde. Parrish with the defensive play at his own blue line. Weimer with the surprise shot. You can see that puck kind of floating and duckling a little bit on the way to Lalinde, who got a piece of it, but it squirted through the pads. 3-1 for the Islanders.
Boy, since the Islanders got the 2-1 goal, good race here between Okoin and Smolinski. Smolinski kept it on side. Back in center. 9:41 remaining in the second period. Adrian Okoin lofts it deep. And Rakunek back to play it.
And that goal will give Ottawa a little confidence.
A steal by Kavasha. He scores! And Mike Sepp, some of that Ottawa confidence. A strip and a goal. And look at Kavasha continue to make that concerted effort to show no emotion. 4-2 New York.
He shows it in his own way. And that's it. This also will be an unassisted goal. Back-to-back unassisted goal. Kavasha with the hard forecheck steals the puck from Rakunek. And is there some emotion? Yeah, there's some emotion there.
That's partying hard.
There it is. Watch the emotion here. Yes.
He's been asked about it over the last couple of games. Of course, he's played so well. And people have been asking him, how come you stopped celebrating?
Score by number 12.
He says he had
Kavasha.
The other day, he said he was just lazy. Too lazy 12, to get the arms up.
Unassisted.
An unassisted goal. And it's 4-2 New York. And that took just a minute 18 after Chara had cut it to 3-2.
Of course, Anaheim was in here the other day. Brian Murray is their general manager.
Avlot shooting. And a putter flying. DiPietro.
Game by a couple. Still doesn't look real comfortable in goal after the collision behind the net with Hammerlick. Still looks like he's hurting, doesn't he? But I'll tell you one thing, he's tough and he's competitive. And he will not come out of that goal unless he is
22nd remaining on the Pekka penalty. 2:40 left in the second period. Hossa with that great burst. Centers puck, big save, DiPietro. Boy, Hossa did it again. One big step. And now back to the blue line. Rettina drive, save, DiPietro, rebound loose. DiPietro makes two more saves. Will bring it out. Pickers out of the box. And with huge help from DiPietro at the end, the Islanders kill the penalty.
I think DiPietro had to make a save on his own player. Trying to clear the puck, they put it right back into him, and he had to be alert. Well, after one period, the score was 1-1. And then this spectacular play by Ola Kavasha. First to get the puck past the defenseman, then the pass to Tchaikovsky. That made it a 2-1 game. Islanders. And then Jason Weimer gets into the act. Good play by Parrish in the neutral zone. Then Weimer with a long shot. A puck that was dipping down. And the goaltender beats DiPietro. And then Ola Kavasha with an unassisted goal of his own. He responds. Good work here on the forecheck. And then the backhand through the legs of Lalime. And the Islanders
the
again
Islanders
had a
zone. And Hammerlick control. Yashin line out. Tchaikovsky has room, goes wide, and Lalime makes the save. Well, let's take a look at our Islanders hockey moment, brought to you by Mohegan Sun. The last time, look at that, a tanned and rested Coach Mike Milbury. This is the last time the Islanders defeated the Ottawa Senators in this building.
And that number 16 is now tanned all the time.
That's right. Tommy Soderstrom, the Islander goaltender. All of that took place on the 6th of January, 1996. A game the Islanders won 5-4. And since then, including the two playoff games, 17 in a row in this building since they last defeated Ottawa. Alexei Yashin, then a Senator, now an Islander, lost it to Rakunin. Those were the early Ottawa Senators who were on their way to an 11-game losing streak. Now Todd White dumps it in. Here's a great trivia question. You know who the coach of the Ottawa Senators was that night?
That night.
When the Islanders beat the Senators in this building that night.
Wasn't Rick Bonus?
No. And there wasn't much room between Bonus and Jacques Martin. Chara comes back, curls it around the board.
Allison?
Yeah, Dave Allison.
Dave Allison.
Right. Brother Mike played in the NHL.
All right. What Dave coach? Only 30 or 35 games,
yeah.
I believe, in the NHL, right?
Right. And then they hired Jacques Martin. Here's Papineau to the net. A backhander. Harams off of Lalime.
Lalime is giving his team a chance.
Middle
of the first period.
Pietro to the corner. Alfredson sends it in front. Pietro scrambling back. Gets cut. company from White.
I think DiPietro got his stick on the puck. Both he and White were reaching for the puck. I think DiPietro beat him to it.
He's out of the net again. Poking it into the corner. You can hear the angst of the crowd here at the Coliseum. And they don't say it in unison, but they're all thinking the same thing. Get back. And now Yanni Nenema leaves it for Janssen at the line. Islanders were changing. I think Janssen did that intentionally. But the Islanders changing.
Oh, boy. Watch it. Look at the watch the stick. And that might have been Kavashi who did a good job as well coming back.
What's Rick will tell you? It's all under control.
Yeah. I got it back. Get out of my...
Now Hossa to the Islander line. And Nenema taken down by Bonk. Boy, I thought Bonk hooked him there.
He did.
It looked like Bonk got that stick in on Nenema, but here's Virata letting one go, and that went wide. Phillips for Bonk. Slips it in front. Johnson trying to get rid of it. Now there's going to be a penalty to the Senators, I believe, although Nenema is arguing. Now, that was the man down in front of DiPietro.
Hossa is getting the penalty for slashing Michael Pekka behind the legs. And that had been going on for a while before Hossa gets called. He was the last man standing. That's why he got called for the penalty. And these two were really using the sticks on one another. Pekka right there on Hossa, pushing, shoving, cross-checking. Pekka goes down once, slash behind. Now Hossa reacts, and there's the last one. And that was the penalty call on Hossa.
Huge for the Islanders. Puts him on the power play with 4.5 to go in the third with a one-goal lead. Second power play for New York.
That's a bad penalty by Hossa. Bad penalty to take with his team trailing by a goal.
We're talking about the occasional lapses in discipline early this season by the Senators. There's another example. Zdeno Chara fires it up the boards. O'Coin, nice play to keep it in. Jurkowski to Yashin. He scores! Zone. Now Hossa tried to go cross ice. Good play by Pekka. Remember, two-goal lead, empty net. Watch DiPietro if he gets to handle the puck, too. He's liable to try to score a goal. Alfredson to Bach. Bach down low. Hossa, DiPietro a save, a scramble. And DiPietro was going to take it to the red line if he could have. At least that's how it would have appeared as he tried to burst out of that pack.
You know, that's a good save. It didn't look like, but if you look at this closely, there's a pass that goes from the goal line to the front. There's the play that was blocked, and then Parrish goes all the way down the ice. Ninema with the beautiful block would have had an assist on the play and deserved it after blocking that one. He put his hands up thinking it was in.
You know, the crowd was chanting, DP, DP, in tribute to DiPietro. There's only one problem. Nobody calls him DP.
Look at, there's Ninemann. Watch, he goes down, and he's watching the play. Watch him react here. He's going in. I've got an assist, right? Oh, he's going to tilt his head just off the post. Parrish thought he had one in. He was leaning. Like a golfer leaning.
Rico. I don't know anybody calls him DP.
There's one.
Well, point to the empty net misses. But, of course, the Islanders have the advantage of being able to ice the puck as they kill a penalty. Minute six to go in the third. Three fewer seconds to the penalty. Another good play by O'Coin.
Has there been a better player on the ice tonight than O'Coin? I'm not sure. There's been a lot of good ones, but I'm not sure anyone's been better than O'Coin.
Well, here's DiPietro handling the puck. This time he plays it to the corner. O'Coin takes a hit. 47 left. Ferrata's drive. Saved DiPietro. And then Bach missed the rebound. Bach knocked down in the corner. Pekka playing without a stick in front of the net. Centering feed. Butted by Alfredson. And grabbed by DiPietro.
Pekka was without a stick, as you mentioned, Howie. And that allowed Alfredson to move in from the point. And that puck, as it deflected, was about shoulder high. And Alfredson batted it in. Watch it. Here's deflected coming up. And there's the baseball bat swing. And DiPietro again with the quick glove holds on. Pekka needs a quick change of gloves as he gets ready for this faceoff. Pekka's taken all the important faceoffs here at the end of this period. He's been out there for nearly 2 minutes. Wins another one.
Alfredson a drive, knocked away, and Bates chucks one towards the empty net, and it misses. 20 seconds remain on the penalty, 22 in the game.
Oh, that was Ninema in front of the net blocking another shot.
O'Coin with a big hit on Bach. Ninema took a spill. Pekka's got the puck. Tried to hit the empty net, instead he hit Redden, who fires, and DiPietro makes a save. Just 6 seconds remaining, and the Islanders have broken a long, long drought. Bates takes one more crack, and did he make it or not?
Well, yes.
The red light and the green light are on simultaneously. No time remains on the clock. It's just a matter of bookkeeping. If they give it to Bates, the Islanders win 6-3. If they don't, they win 5-3.
I think it made it in the last maybe under a second to go. There you see the clock. Bates gets to the red line. At that point, it's in just before time expires. What a win for the Islanders here at the Coliseum. 6-3 will be the final. And they trailed 1-0 in this game and scored a late goal with just over a minute to go in the first period to tie it at 1. And that guy right there was spectacular. And he was some kind of player tonight.
You know how long that's been in days? Eric Hornick computes 2,858 days.
That's too many.
Yeah. Well, that drought's over with. Rick DiPietro and the Islanders have their second consecutive win as they beat the Ottawa Senators for the first time in more than 7 years in this building. And what a start they're off to here at the Coliseum, too.
Yeah.
You know, last year, they were just the 500 team at home, but they're 5-1 in this building so far.
5-1, and this was an important game because I think the Islanders proved to themselves that they could beat an elite team and do it in a number of different ways. They were able to score even strength goals against four even strength goals against Ottawa, which had only given up 5 coming into this game in 9 games. So the Islanders scored scored even strength goals. Their penalty killing again tonight was excellent. And Yashin had, you know, Yashin had a terrific game again. Scored a goal. He feels good about what's going on. Likes the system, likes the coach.
Third star of the game, and before they introduced him, it's a lot of emotion for him, too.
But it is.
Talking to all the fans.
28, Jason Weimer.
Weimer, good job, second star.
And the first star from the New York Islanders, number 12, Oleg
Okoin. Well, I mean, I don't take anything away from those three players, but I think Okoin needs another mention here. He was so good killing penalties and setting up plays, and just a huge win for the Islanders.
Islanders tie the Philadelphia Flyers
by 10 in the Sens. Can you believe this? You were saying this, Darren. A strange stat. Unbeaten in 17 straight on Long Island. How about that? Midway through the first, out the faceoff. Martin Havlat back to Pache. His shot deflected by Peter Schaefer. Peter the Great. Well, all right, we'll call him Peter the Mediocre, but he was pretty great there, and it was 1-0 to the Senators. Short time after that, Islanders short-handed. Scary moment. Jason Blake hit by Alfredson, and there is the old twist. And he would come out for one more shift, but then had to leave the game, and Blake is going to be reevaluated, we're told, tomorrow. So the prayers for him tonight. Hopefully he'll come back. Late in the period, Sean Bates drops to Trent Hunter. Oh, the old Blue Bayou, the Crystal Gale shot. As Patrick Lehm couldn't handle that, and we were tied at 1-1 early in the second. Kovashev on the left side in front to Marius Tchaikovsky. That's going to be the play as he sneaks a peek. There's Tchaikovsky. How did he know he was there? He did. Tchaikovsky's ninth, just like a symphony, and the Islanders lead it 2-1. Another scare for the Islanders. Hamerlich runs into Rick DiPietro, his own goaltender. Now DiPietro gets up and gets back in time to make the save. You got to have a little bit of rock. You got to have a little bit of roll, baby. DiPietro shaken, but he stayed in the game. On the other end, Islanders looking for more. Bates looking for Hunter. Great save by Lalime. Lalime, that puck-stopping machine. And a short time later, though, Jason Weimer, the former Calgary Flame, taking aim. Oh, that's not good. Take another look. Twice is not as nice. Twice is just as ugly, and it was 3-1 for the Islanders. A couple of minutes after that, though, the Sens do come back. Zdeno Chara with a goal. It's a big goal for the program. They're back in the game, but just over a minute after that, the Islanders have this response. Decision with a bad giveaway. Oleg Kavasha beats Lalime, and it was 4-2 for the Islanders. A minute and a half left in the second period. Daniel Alfredson weaving his magic. The old bob and weave play, and that's his seventh. And Ottawa, again, right back in it. They trail 4-3 after two. Late in the third, the Islanders will put it away, and here's how they do it. Sens can't clear. They had problems in that regard tonight. Tchaikovsky goes to Alexei Yashin. Oh, you people in Ottawa don't want to see that. That really bugs the people in Ottawa when Yashin scores a goal like that. And eventually the Islanders double up on the Senators 6-3. So the Sens lose on Long Island for the first time since, check this out, folks, January 6, 1996. Yes, that's a span of 17 games. But what about Tchaikovsky? At his sixth multi-point game of the season, well, the guy's absolutely on fire. We talked about it. He's got 9 goals now. Why, oh, why could he have not have done that?
That was a span of almost 8 years. They get it off started right. Zdeno Chara from the point. His shot tipped in front by Peter Schaefer, and it goes in past Rick DiPietro. 1-0 Ottawa. Jason Blake gets tangled up here along the boards with Daniel Alfredson. Falls to the ice, and on his way down, suffered a knee injury. We're told that it's a mild knee sprain. Had to leave the game, would not return. Last minute of the period, Sean Bates drops it back for Trent Hunter. His shot beats Patrick Lalime. For Hunter, it's his fourth of the year. Game tied at 1. Second period, it's Oleg Kavasha across to Marius Tchaikovsky. Number 9 on the year for Tchaikovsky gives the Islanders a 2-1 lead. Jason Weimer just crosses center ice and beats Lalime with that shot. Take another look. Somehow gets past Lalime. 3-1 Isles. But the Senators do respond. Chara beats DiPietro, his third of the season, cuts the lead to 3-2. The Isles regain their two-goal advantage. Kavasha steals it, comes out front, and in past Lalime. 4-2 New York. The Sens make it a one-goal game thanks to Daniel Alfredson's seventh of the year. But that's as close as the Sens would get tonight. The streak finally ends. On the power play, Tchaikovsky across to Alexei Yashin on the one-timer. Islanders win 6-3. Bates would add an empty netter for the Islanders. The Sens 0-6 with the man advantage tonight. So Ottawa's streak ends at 17 games without a loss at Nassau Coliseum. It's only their fourth loss in their last 30 meetings versus the Islanders since the start of the 96-97 season.
Second period, tied at one. Oleg Kvasia, sweet pass to Marius Cherkasky. The Polish prince goes roof daddy. That's his ninth at the other end. Patrick Lalime, huge save. This not as spectacular, though. Jason Weimer will beat Lalime from way out. That's his first. It's a softie. It's 3-1 for the Isles. The Sens are going to answer right back. Former Islanders, Zdeno Chara, rips one by Rick DiPietro. That's his third. Sends down 3-2. Then Curtis Lysishyn and Kyle Rakunin get crushed up. Oleg Kvasia says, thank you very much. That's his fourth. That makes it 4-2. Late in the second, Alfredson's going to cut that lead in half. That's his seventh already. Sends down 4-3 after two. Third period, DiPietro, who got the start in this one, gets caught wandering. Almost gets burned. Just gets back in time to avoid disaster. This fan, not the least bit worried, because the Isles have guys like Mike Pekka. He's all over Hossa. Hossa frustrated, two hands him. Pekka goes down. He gets two for that. On the ensuing power play, Cherkasky to Yashin. He goes top cheese. That's his fifth. How sweet it is for the former Sen. The Isles finally beat Ottawa on home ice, 6-3 the final. The Islanders knock out the Senators for the first time at the Nassau County Coliseum since January the 6th, 1996. The Islanders have killed 54 of 58 penalties this season. That ranks first in the National Hockey League. It was key again tonight. The Senators go 0-6. Marius Cherkasky, just five goals
last. The teams did battle again in Nassau County on Monday night, and the Senators scored first 8 minutes in. This is Brian Papier from the point, and the tip in by Peter Schaefer. Take another look, and you'll see why Rick DiPietro had little chance on this one. He went left, puck went right. That's 1-0 Ottawa. A couple minutes later, injury to insult. Daniel Alfredson knee to knee with Jason Blake. Blake went into the boards hard, strained right knee. He'll be re-examined on Tuesday. Not good news for the Islanders, but just over a minute to go in the first, Sean Bates to Trent Hunter, who beats Patrick Lalime stick side, fourth of the year for Hunter. And the start of a bad night for the Ottawa goaltender. A minute into the second, watch this pass. Oleg Kvasia backhand through the legs to Marius Cherkasky for the ninth goal of the year for Cherkasky. 2-1 Islander. 7 minutes later, Jason Weimer from about 80. How does that one go in? Through Lalime, it's now 3-1 Islanders. First of the year for Weimer, and Islanders weren't done. Watch the forechecking job by Kvasia. 1-on-2. Says, I'll take it, and I'll put it right between your legs. Lalime had no chance again. Fourth of the year for Kvasia, and it's 4-2 Isles. Now 4-3. Third period, power play. One-time slap shot by one-time Ottawa Senator Alexei Yashin. Fifth goal of the year. Islanders added an empty netter, and lo and behold, they win. On Long Island against Ottawa, 6-3 the final. First win against the Senators in Nassau County since January 6th of 1996. We told you about Jason Blake. He'll be re-examined on Tuesday. Nine different Islanders were in the scoring column, including Kvasia, who had a goal and an assist in this one. And the Islanders' penalty killers have now allowed only four goals in 54 chances this year. Ottawa was 0-6 on the power play, and that was just one topic of discussion for the men who called the game. Howie Rose.
The bench with Islanders head coach Steve Sterling, coming off of a good solid win against Ottawa, another good strong team in Dallas here tonight. But really, I guess tying everything together is the play of your first line with Yashin between Kvasia and Cherkasky. How do you account for the chemistry that seems to have developed?
Well, I saw the chemistry a couple years ago, and there was times that they played well together. Then obviously Marius wasn't around a year ago, and Ole had his ups and downs, but I think for me, they're working hard at it, both with and without the puck, but they feel good about themselves. They got some points. They scored early, not necessarily in the game the other night, but early in the season. They scored some goals, made some plays, got some power plays going, so I think they're just confident.
Well, Kvasia's a guy who's had some good but relatively small stretches of continuous strong play in the past, but now he's sustained it pretty much since opening night. Does that tell you he's turned a corner, or is it too soon to say?
No, well, it's always a little too soon to say based on what we've seen in the past, but I like his first 11 games. He's only, for me, maybe only one of those games in which I wasn't happy, and that was his play without the puck, and we talked about it, but he's skating, he's working with and without the puck, and for me, the most important thing is without the puck.
Well, tonight's game, in some ways, is really a tribute to what the Islanders organization has been able to do over the last few years, infusing young talent into this team. That you're going to have five rookies in the lineup tonight, including Mapletoff, plus Rick DiPietro, who's not technically a rookie, but, of course, you've had most of these guys coming through. Is the corner turned in that regard, too?
Well, certainly with Bridgeport the last couple of years, and the depth that we've been able to accumulate has certainly helped us. And the young kids are ready, as you said, Hunter and Bergenheim and Goddard and Papineau and Ricky, obviously, and then Mapletoff on the call up. That these young kids have paid their dues. They've played hard. They're in. Even Hunter and Papineau here have paid their dues, but they're ready to go, and we need them to go.
Well, tonight's opponent, the Dallas Stars, come off of a 3-0 loss to the Rangers the other night. Does that make this game even a little bit more scary for you because of how, you know, what they came off of the other night?
Well, there's no question. And we talked about it this morning, and we'll continue to talk about it before or during the game. They'll come in hungry. They'll come in with some pride, and they'll come in nasty, and not necessarily in the physical play. They're a big, strong, skating, physical team anyway, but they're going to be hungry for a win and come right at us early in the game, so we'll have to be ready.
We've only got about 15, 20 seconds here, but I know one of the things Mapletoft went down to work on was offense. What does that mean specifically?
Well, for me, it was just getting minutes. I'd go down and play a power play and penalty, you know, do the penalty killing and take a regular shift and gain some confidence just playing, going, you know, playing in all three zones. That he did, and while he was doing it, he played hard and put up some numbers, but for me it was based on his playing hard and working at his game versus anything he did or didn't do offensively.
And he'll be rewarded with a shift tonight for the Islanders against the Dallas Stars. Mapletoft, one of a slew of young Islanders in the lineup tonight.
Starting with the Boys and Girls Club of Oyster Bay, the Islanders will be donating street hockey equipment and sending out Islander players during the season to meet groups of very excited kids as they hit the streets for Long Island. Things didn't start out too smoothly, though, for the Islanders' goaltender.
I'm from Boston, Massachusetts. I am a Red Sox fan. See some Yankees jerseys. Come on. That's all right, you guys did beat us. What's going on with the Jets, though?
He did touch on some subjects that resonated with the kids, like nutrition, responsibility, and staying in school.
The kids, I think, really got a lot out of what he said, and, you know, Rick is a role model to these kids, and I'm sure the kids will take that back to their houses, to their schools, and take the words that he said very seriously.
I love it. This is great to come out and see the kids, and especially when you get a chance to play street hockey. I'm still a little kid at heart and like to come out here and shoot some pucks around and have a good time with the kids.
Do you remember being a kid and, you know, having someone like you come in and talk and sort of give advice and that kind of thing?
You know what? I remember being a kid and getting an opportunity to meet Andy Moog for the first time. It was like my complete idol, and I couldn't say a word. I couldn't say hi.
Even you couldn't say a word.
Could you imagine me tongue-tied? I couldn't say a word. I just sat there with a stupid look on my face and let him talk to me, and to this day, I still regret not asking him for his autograph or anything.
Playing coach for a day, introducing some first-timers to 4-on-4. All right, James, are you ready now to take it one game at a time?
Well, yeah.
Did you give it 110%? You're just playing for the team?
Yeah. I'm trying to make it good.
Did you score a goal?
Yeah. So only one in the whole game.
The only one in the whole game to score. Did Rick DiPietro teach you everything you know?
Yeah.
Say you owe your career to him?
Yeah.
Rick DiPietro, the greatest to those kids. You know, his teammates have seen all along what a character he is. The community is starting to see that as well. Jenna Wolf of the MSU Sports Desk is next.
These three players have been unstoppable.
Yeah, they've scored just about half of the team's goals. Maybe the biggest story among the three is Oleg Kavasha because of how consistent he's been since opening night, and Yashin is really impressed with his progress.
It just takes some time to develop qualities, like hockey qualities, and I think he has a great talent, and you know, again, it just really how you can perform under pressure and in front of a lot of people, you know, because from a talent point, he has all of that, you know, and just sometimes to put together, and he was doing that very goodly.
Yeah, and the record he broke was Tony Esposito, someone who grew up in the same hometown as Marty Turco. And Marty Turco, is he going to have those numbers again? No, but is he playing? I think like people expected, that's no also. He's somewhere certainly in between, and Deb mentioned the save percentage. That has got to get better.
The Islanders going with a Yashin line up front with Janssen and Ninema back. And for Dallas, Stu Barnes, number 14, sets up Madonna on a centering feed, did not get through, but there's going to be a penalty to the Islanders here.
Now, the penalty is called because of the turnover, and before we get to that, let's take a look at tonight's scratches for this game for the Dallas Stars. They certainly miss Yuri Lehtinen, one of the best two-way players in the game. Don Sweeney and Aaron Downey, both healthy, and there you see the scratches that Depp talked about. Radek Martinek, the only healthy one of that group.
Well, 20 seconds into the game, Ninema goes to the box, and the Stars go to the power play. The Islanders, the top-ranked penalty-killing unit in the league. This is number 27, Seppo Nieminen, shooting one all the way through. That's held by Rick DiPietro, and the Islanders have allowed just one power play goal against their last 26 times shorthanded.
Now, Steve Sterling said this is going to be a key part to this game. He says what's difficult to defend against this Dallas power play, he says they've got all these great players and they're hard to find. He said they know how to find the seam, so his penalty killers are going to have to stop and start and go in straight lines and keep your sticks in the passing lane. He says because Madonna will all of a sudden disappear and then he'll show up someplace. And of course, back on defense, Zubov is one of the great passers in the game.
Yeah, he might be as good a power play quarterback as there is in the National Hockey League. That's Sergei Zubov, number 56. He and Nieminen are the point men, with Madonna, number 9, Guerin, number 13, and Jason Arnott, number 44, up front. DiPietro way out of the net. Put it off the glass, but not out. Pressure from O'Coin. Guerin lets it go towards Madonna, but Bergenheim steps up, got it to the line, and with a second effort, out of the zone. So 48 seconds gone on the penalty. And Bergenheim will get more penalty-killing responsibilities in the absence of Jason Blake. Now it's Guerin winding it around. Pass DiPietro. Arnett shovels it the other way. Hammerlick's there. Got hemmed in by Madonna. So Guerin for Dallas. Swings it the other way. Nieminen keeps it in. Guerin lets it go to Madonna. Mike Madonna looks for a play in front, but gave it away to Bates. And Sean Bates sends it down the ice.
And that was good pressure by O'Coin on Madonna. And kind of an ill-advised pass by Madonna. And again, he's not nearly, not anywhere close to being at the top of his game.
DiPietro tries to move it quickly. Didn't get it out of the zone. Pierre Turgeon, the former Islander, number 77. Turgeon holds on. Nobody in front yet. Now he sends it to the net, broken up by a diving Cairns, and sent to the line. Zubov held it in. 12 seconds left to the Dallas power play. Turgeon looked for Morrow. O'Coin bumped Turgeon. Scott Young, number 48, chops it the other way. Parrish gets a step, takes a hit from Turgeon as he sends it all the way down, and the Islanders with another successful penalty kill.
Boy, what a job that
25.
Was.
What? As the second period begins.
Tchaikovsky and Matvichuk having a talk at the faceoff circle as they get ready for this. Remember the hit Matvichuk had on Tchaikovsky at the end of that first period. And they were discussing, I think it was a continuation of that discussion that they had.
Tchaikovsky now in position as the puck finally dropped, and then Yashin and Barnes exchange little jabs with a stick right off the draw. And the Islanders will have to come out from their own zone here as Adrian O'Coin leads them ahead. O'Coin with Hammerlick and Yashin, Kavasha, Tchaikovsky up front. Kept in by Hammerlick. Nieminen failed to clear. Yashin for Kavasha. Now Nieminen steps into Yashin. Alexi Yashin has scored goals in each of his last three games, and he's on the power play here. But that spins past Hammerlick. Alexi Yashin, now a 30-year-old, celebrated birthday number 30 yesterday. And here is Yashin up to the Dallas line. Kavasha couldn't control it. Numanen had deflected it in the first place.
Now, the Islanders did a good job there, carrying the puck into the zone, and you can do that against Dallas. They like to put pressure on the neutral zone, as they do there. If you can beat that initial pressure, then their defense are forced to back in.
Michael Pekka around towards Hamelin. Final 14 to the Islanders' power play. And Rob DeMaio stepped away from Pekka. Enema keeps it in. Out of the box now comes Arnett. And the teams are at full strength. No shots for the Islanders on that power play. Pekka or Parrish. Tried to get it to Weimer. Modano broke it up. Parrish grabs it back. Sets up Weimer. Nobody in front yet. Pekka cruises that way. Weimer throws it at the net. Score! Parrish! Mark Parrish breaks an 8-game goalless streak. And the Islanders take a 1-0 lead.
Holly, Mark Parrish made that original play by right there stealing the puck from Zubov when it looked like Zubov was going to clear. And eventually Weimer just says, hey, won't hurt to throw the puck at the net. Mark Parrish, I don't think, has had the puck in front of the net in 8 games. He does there, puts it in. The Islanders lead it 1-0. Parrish made the good play and then just sneaks in from the other side. So first he steals the puck from Zubov. Then he gets better position in front of the net on Zubov and is able to get to the loose puck.
Long drive by Guerin, sails out of play. I remember mentioning on the first power play the Islanders had in the first period, Parrish at one point uncharacteristically had drifted back to the blue line. I don't recall if that was just a cover for a defenseman who had gone into the corner, but you've never seen him out of the blue line on a power play.
No, I mean, he just, think about the scoring droughts. You think of that time period where he doesn't touch the puck. And that's
him.
If you can get him to puck anywhere around the net, that's when he's going to score like he did earlier in the season. And score in bunches.
Now Weimer and Pekka pick up the assists at 1:43 of the second period. And the Islanders have the 1-0 lead. Enema around for Janssen with a Pekka line up front. Tried to throw it to the net. Broke it up by Numanen. Robidon, number 17. Actually, it was Robidon who had made that block, sending it into the corner. And Parrish steps into Arnett. Ott of Dallas, number 29. Here's from Ninema. Arnett back on the puck. Guerin to Robidon. Guerin throws it at the net. Steered away. Pietro with a good play. Weimer chops it all the way down. And they wave the icing off.
Now, that's a big line that Michael Pekka's line is out there against. Big and physical. And thus far, they've done a good job against them in this game.
And now the Bates-Hunter-Hefano unit out against the Pierre Turgeon line. Turgeon chops it up the middle. Hefano gets it back. Turco doesn't field it, so Hunter absorbs the hit as he moves the puck. Bates pressuring Pierre Turgeon. Once upon a time, Pierre Turgeon had a 132-point season for the Islanders. And here's Turgeon into the zone. Quick shot block.
42 points last year, his lowest since his rookie season.
He was once drafted first overall by the Buffalo Sabres back in 87. One of the parties of the other part. Pat LaFontaine left the Islanders. Turgeon centers. Whoever knocked down was Malhotra in front of the net. Matt Tkachuk put it behind the goal line. Scott Young, number 48, gets help from Numanen. Now Turgeon throws it at the feet of DiPietro. And it caroms to Papineau.
Howie, that was Trent Hunter in front of the net that came back and made a nice defensive play on Malhotra, getting his stick.
Yetnin checked by O'Coyne. And Hunter worked it deep into the Dallas zone. Bergenheim attempting to lock up Teppo Numanen. The Stars get it out. DeMaio couldn't get through O'Coyne, however. Now DeMaio gets a second chance. Nico Kampanen, number 39, took a big hit from Hamerlich. And then Miettinen delivers one on Hamerlich, only to have O'Coyne level Miettinen or Kampanen. And that shot from Zubov went wide. Tkachuk hit by Goddard. Things get a little feisty now. Hamerlich steps into DeMaio.
And Howie, while that was going on, Justin Mapletoff came back to the front of the net and made a good defensive play with his stick on a pass that was going across the crease.
Didn't it seem, Joe, as though those were the kinds of defensive plays he made instinctively last year?
Yes. Very smart player. Always looks around, very aware of who's on the ice and where they are.
Now Hammerlick. Up the left side, Kavasha, Rashad off of Turco, and out of play. Well, he leaned into it.
Now, only Kavasha coming off the bench to take that pass and then get the shot. Turco able to deflect it up and over the glass. We take a look at our Panasonic digital replay. Look at the big hit by Hammerlick, who then gets hit, and then this one, O'Coin comes over. And there's the defensive play I was talking about, Mapletoff, on Sergei Zubov.
Oh, Newman right off the draw. Nenema fired it over the net. Now a one-timer by Nenema, and that hits the glass. Cleared by Erskine, but deflected on the way through. So DiPietro will play it. Nenema steers it right to Yashin. Zubov was changing. Yashin had a little room there. Couldn't control the puck, but now Morrow skips away from Nenema. Modano to the net. The pass deflected away by Janssen. Good defensive play by Kenny Janssen, who goes right at Brendan Morrow. He sets up Matt Tkachuk. That drive came out hard. Modano couldn't. Fisherman jersey did the draw. Modano trying to snap one through traffic. Morrow knocked down in front of the net. And that loose stick belongs to Kenny Janssen, who has it shoved back towards him by Yanni Nenema, who made a good play. Yashin in over the line. Shot stopped. Rebound Yashin. Centering feed. Pass Kavasha. Matvichuk had made the first block. Yashin made a nice play to get it right back to the slot. Now Morrow hears from Nenema. Modano feeds Barnes. That backhander blocked again. Janssen blocked it. Yashin holds up on Newman, and Tchaikovsky follows in deep. Tchaikovsky, nothing there. But Kavasha goes behind the net with Newman in. Look for Tchaikovsky, got knocked down by Modano and nothing called. And Stu Barnes sends Modano ahead. Now to Morrow. Brendan Morrow floats it through the slot right to Barnes, and now Modano. Up past Modano, and Janssen gets rid of it. Kenny Janssen's iced the puck here. Erskine back to make it official with 8:05 remaining in the second.
What a play by Tchaikovsky. Tchaikovsky had the shot on one end, and then Dallas came back the other way, and he ends up coming all the way back this way to defend. Look at this. It's a 3-on-2. Look at Tchaikovsky. Head down, right there. Watch him make the play. Defensive play right there on Stu Barnes. And that's a terrific play, and that kind of, you know, puts it all in perspective what Tchaikovsky's game is all about. Getting a chance on one end and then not forgetting about defense.
It's going to look great in Poland. Still has that Polish TV crew following
right.
him around.
Yeah.
Every step he takes.
Yeah.
Be with him for, what did he say, 2 more days?
No, he said before the game. I talked to him before the game and he said it's all about, he said they got to keep focusing. And there it is again. Look at him. He's got his head down. This is at the end of a shift. He's already tired. And he does that and helped prevent a shot on goal by Stu Barnes. That's great work. Great work.
Off the draw, Erskine shot wide. Boy, a lot of face-offs in the Islanders. And yet another Islander zone. Weimer is excused, and Pekka will take it instead against Jason Arnott. Arnott wins it back to Zubov. Weimer got a stick on that. Just does get it past the diving of Steve Ott. Parrish challenges Zubov. And Janssen up the right wing and out. Newman in and Zubov, the defense pair. This is Zubov. And Bill Guerin chips it in, tries to go over Kenny Janssen.
He made the play again. Oh, I mean, Kenny Janssen, every time he's on the ice, he does something way above average.
And now Ott challenging down the middle. Kapanen goes to the net. Ott throws it, and it got through to DiPietro. Ott bumped by Parrish. There's Janssen again, challenged by Kapanen.
He's a standout in this game.
Islanders changing. Tchaikovsky to the backhand. I think Jansen by far has been their best defenseman, and that's not to take anything away from the others. Kenny's been involved everywhere. Now Yashin, double team, keeps the puck, then lost the handle, got it back, save made, rebound to Cherkovsky, hopped over his stick. And DeMaio with a pass broken up by O'Coin before Mietnin sends it in. Andy Mietnin, number 20. A long shot, 224th overall pick playing for the Stars. Butenschon in over the line. He took a bump from Mietnin. And now Zubov connects with Mietnin, who didn't hold it. Islanders try to turn it quickly around. Barnes gets it back. Kavasha broke it up. Barnes again with Madonna. Centers Madonna. Oh, a DiPietro with a king-size pick save. Save of the night for Rick DiPietro.
Save of the year by Rick DiPietro.
And Kavasha gets it back.
That was spectacular. I mean, that looked like a gimme right there. That's like one of those little two-inch putts. They just say, take it. It's in. And especially with Madonna there and DiPietro, the save of the year. This had tie game written all over it. Look at it. How do you stop that? Great athletic ability is how you do it, and not quitting on a play. And Madonna's got to be shaking his head. Back while we were in the timeout, it was Madonna staring up at the big screen, trying to figure out what happened.
Not like he did anything wrong either. DiPietro with a spectacular save. Playing his third straight game.
The same here. I'm not sure. Why don't we look at both of them? We'll let you people at home decide. Here's the goal. Mark Parrish gives it up and then steals it back from Zubov, who couldn't clear. This is an Islander power play. And then just as it ends, Weimer throws it in front. Parrish goes back and pump muscles Zubov to get position and scores the goal, makes it 1-0. And then Rick DiPietro got kicked in the head on that play by Ott. But this is the save of the year for DiPietro. Beautiful feed from Barnes to Mike Madonna, one of the great offensive players in the game. And DiPietro stoned him.
You mean the save of the year so far?
Yeah, he might even have a better full strength and then get that timing back with his offense.
Now the Yashin line on. Yashin wins a draw. In him up, but in behind the net. Ashen's there, so are a pair of Stars, and it's Newman in emerging with it. Stu Barnes, softly into the Islanders zone, 4.5 to go in the third. Janssen, around the net, strong skating play by Janssen. Out of Kavasha, feeds Yashin, tries to recover, and it was Barnes chopping it loose.
The line's a threat every time they're on the ice, aren't they?
This is Morrow the other way, putting it in front, and another good play by Janssen.
Kenny Janssen has been so spectacular this game. Every chip, with and without the puck. And then he makes another play, using the stick on Morrow to knock the puck all the way back to the Dallas blue line. I mean, this is some kind of performance. We raved about O'Coin last game. Kenny Janssen's been as good as O'Coin was last game.
Now here is O'Coin. For Bates. 3:47 to go on the third. Erskine slowed Bergenheim up a bit. And now Hunter's got it back and sends it deep. Bates takes off after it. Turgar out for Erskine. But Bates, with help from the referee, gets it back. Now Bates trying to shake loose of Erskine. Wheels it in front off of the defenseman, John Erskine. But Hunter has it. Hunter behind the net, out from behind. Turns. Gives the Islanders the lead, and it's late. 3:06.
gets on the puck, tries to get it to the front, and now the Stars, that was Erskine again that gave it away there, and eventually Hunter finishes it off. So Erskine had a couple of giveaways on the one play, and Hunter, and not only did he block that shot, but he had a couple of the hardest hits, I think, that the Islanders have had in this game, and he gets reminded almost on a daily basis by his coach, Steve Sterling, to stay in this league. Finish your checks. They know he's got good hands. And what Steve Sterling said is
more than ever.
The job Bob Hartley is doing down there, dealing with that.
We'll see that on Saturday night. First, the Islanders have to finish this business. The 26 to go in the third. Hammerlick in the corner. Up the boards, and Weimer chips it past Sergei Zubov, number 56.
And a quick change for the Islanders.
Here's Bates in the Islanders zone. Spreading it wide to Kavasha. Fake the shot as Bates with him, sets up Bates, moves it. He scores! Same way. when they see kids that have been developed within their system come up and have an impact, because it speaks about not only the short term, but the long term. Here's DiPietro establishing himself, his third straight win. First time he's ever done that. Hunter's come. Obviously had a big impact over the last couple of weeks.
And the other thing it does is it tells these young kids
number 29, Kenny Jansen.
He's a third star, but he can also be the second on.
There he is without a stick.
The second star from the New York Islanders, number 39,
DiPietro's going to have two of them.
Mike Modano was just
and
one that they'll show over and over and over and over again.
Trent Hunter.
And Trent Hunter had another big game. He did so many different things, including scoring the game winner, but blocking shots and taking the man and playing well defensively. Can you say Trent Hunter? What a play Trent Hunter makes here. Behind the net, fights off Pierre Turgeon and then turns, and look at the beautiful goal. Perfect. Over the glove of Marty Turco. The place erupted at that point. Here's another look at it. Great work from Hunter to turn and score that goal. That made it a 2-1 game. The Islanders added a couple of late ones.
Flying Second Dallas Stars win. Brought their act into town, but it was all Islanders who were stars on the ice tonight. What a week. Anaheim, then Ottawa, and now Dallas. The final 4-1, and the game was closer than the score would indicate. Michael Pekka put it away with an empty net. A Rick DiPietro made the save of the year on Mike Modano right there, and that was it for the Islanders. They were on their way. We'll see you again with Geico Islanders game night at 6:30 on Saturday night, and then the game, Thrashers and Islanders. Thanks to my guys, Kevin Mottinger and Larry Roth, Charlie Kuchera, and Pete McCavely. I'm Deb Kaufman. See you later from the Coliseum. Islanders win again.
For Sean Bates from Massachusetts intercepts and clears the puck.
Great penalty killer, Sean Bates. Scores a lot of shorthanded goals. Dangerous when he's out there.
First goal of the game, American-born Mark Parrish. Parrish's fourth of the season, 1-0 Islanders. Barry, talk about this one from the Minnesota native.
Typical Parrish goal. He beats the defenseman down low. That Zubov doesn't tie him up. Good work here. The people with Parrish know, get the puck to the front net. Mark will be there. Gets a majority of his goals right from that area. Very tough to check, but Zubov's got to do a better job.
Rudy Pooh, smackdown.
Oh,
what a hit. A coin on Nico Kapanen. Later second, Stars down 1-0. Stu Barnes to Modano. DiPietro. Got quick legs, Panger.
Oh, he's got to move from his left to his right here. And because he's a wrong-handed catching goaltender, he's able to push across, get the right pad out there. And if the pad wasn't there, the glove was there. What a save.
Mike.
He's got to go higher, Bear.
Watch Hunter right here. That's the way to
play. What a goal. Trent Hunter's fifth of the year, off to a good start. And the Isles are big winners. They're in first place to beat the Stars.
2-2 tie in the third game of the regular season in Atlanta. Second of four meetings. Hamrlik and O'Coin, the defense pair. Patrick Stefan, number 27, up front with Sean McEachran, number 19. Kozlov, number 13 for Atlanta, as Yashin was unable to get the puck deep. And the puck back out to center. Kavasha nudges one ahead. Recovered by Kamberle, celebrating his 30th birthday tonight. Glad to be in the game because he was scratched last night.
Yeah, the previous three games, actually, he's been scratched. And he's their best puck-handling defenseman. And this is a team that's been struggling a little bit.
Inima to Kavasha, tried to feed Yashin. A save off Tchaikovsky, who got a second shot, too, at Pasi Nurminen. And immediately, Randy Robitaille in center is unable to get the puck past Kavasha. So the Islanders with some early pressure here in the opening minute.
You know, Atlanta lately has been struggling to start games. In fact, they've given up 33 goals this year, and over half of those, 17, in the first period. The Islanders almost had one there on the turnover after a beautiful pass from Kavasha.
Jason Weimer dumps it in. The carom comes right to Nurminen. And sent ahead, but not out. Jason Weimer with a body check on Jean-Pierre Vigier, number 11. And this is Daniel Tarnqvist, number 36 on defense. Up to Robitaille. The former Islander Randy Robitaille bounces one that DiPietro fields as the teams begin to change on the move, a minute and a half in.
Now this morning, Steve Sterling told his team, let's start this game and go right after them. They've been struggling a little bit. In fact, seven of the last nine games for Atlanta, they have fallen behind by at least two goals. So Steve Sterling said, be aggressive, but stay within our system and go after them.
Sean Bates take it in hard by Garnet Exelby, number two. Now working the corner, it's Hunter. And the third forward on this line, Bergenheim. Hunter's shot, he scores! be four straight games in which he's scored a goal. And Bates has been just as hot. I started to mention that the other night they had Papineau starting on left wing on that unit. They moved Sean Bergenheim up partway through the game, and he played well there and stays on that line tonight. And the Thrashers now are called for icing.
Well, Steve Sterling said this morning, he said as he was watching that last game, he just felt through one and a half periods that Bergenheim was a better player, was more effective in all aspects of the game. Here it is again. And we'll take another look. The quick shot. There's no question that Bates had to stick there and a little bit of room between the pads of Nurminen, and I'm not sure if he touched it or not. Hard to tell from that angle.
Well, they haven't made an announcement yet, so they're still trying to sort through it. But either way, the Islanders with the early lead, and out come the Atlanta Thrashers led by McEachran. The veteran Sean McEachran pulls up, feeds Cabrelet. His shot deflects over the net. Yashin on Kozlov. Kozlov number 13 with Stefan and McEachran. Here's Kozlov again turning on Yashin. McEachran picks Yashin off. Then Hammerlick knocked down as Martinik just gloves the puck into the corner. Stefan is there trying to lose Hammerlick. Patrick Stefan met at the side of the net. Nice play defensively by Kavasha to pick him up. And now Kavasha nudges one over the line and up the left side. Tchaikovsky with Yashin. Feeds Yashin. Tried to get it back. Went off the stick of Sutton. But here's Yashin centering Kavasha. He was ridden away by Patrick Stefan. But Kavasha gets it back. Throws it in front of the net. Tchaikovsky for Yashin. A save by Nurse. Met him halfway. Blue line. Let's go to our Nissan trivia question for tonight. The first and last goalies who gave up goals to Pat LaFontaine. First one was in 1984. I believe in his second game, right after he joined the Islanders off of Team USA. Came to the Islanders at the same time that Patrick Flatley joined the Islanders, right off of Team Canada.
Is JD still playing then?
Is that a loaded question? Well,
it's a technicality. I'm just wondering.
Kavasha centers right at the feet of Tchaikovsky. Tchaikovsky again across, and Yashin stuffed by Nurminen. And now we're hearing that they're changing the scoring, and they're taking it away from Hunter. Tchaikovsky goes to the front. Kavasha looks for Yashin. Hammerlick, a wrist shot, save made. Tchaikovsky stopped on the rebound, and another shot by Tchaikovsky went wide.
This line is dominant, and Nurminen is keeping Atlanta in it.
Tchaikovsky fires. Does he score? The red light's on. They immediately say, let's go upstairs. Now, the Islanders say it's 2-0, but the referee immediately pointed straight upstairs and says, let's go to the videotape.
Nurminen knows it was in. The shot was, I believe, was either a little deflected and it knuckleballed, I believe, over the shoulder of Nurminen. And to me, I heard kind of that sound that it hits when it hits the middle, the top post. Now there's the puck coming back down. I think it went in the net and hit that bar that's around the back, because it gives you kind of a hollow sound, and that's the way it sounded to me.
Boy, you're right about Nurminen and his body language in the immediate aftermath.
Right.
Watch him react.
Let's see. I mean, kind of a knuckler. Yeah, see, it hits that middle bar. It's kind of a hollow sound, and Nurminen right away knows. I mean, he stopped because he knows that sound also, knows it was in. And this line is just, I mean, they are something, aren't they? I mean, every shift, they seem to put pressure on, and Tchaikovsky is now two goals within the league lead.
So they award the goal to Marius Tchaikovsky. And for Marius, double digits. And the Islanders have a 2-0 lead. Johnny Nenema tried to fire it around the boards. He drilled J.P. Vigier of Atlanta. And the Thrashers operating in the Islander zone with Vigier putting it off the leg of Nenema. So Parrish being hounded by Randy Robitaille. He then steps into Weimer. But Janssen gets it back in the Islander line, taking a shove from Kovalchuk.
I think Weimer stepped into Robitaille, and he's still shaking.
Wound around by Sharnquist. Hekka spins it the other way. So again, the bookkeeping changed the first goal from Hunter to Bates. Hunter will get the second assist, Bergenheim the first. And now Tchaikovsky's 10th from Yashin, and Hammerlick at 1:13 makes it 2-0 New York.
And how I mentioned Irwin keeping his team in it, to keep his team in it.
Eric Cairns with a setup for Trent Hunter. That's deflected into the corner. Hunter gets it back. Recovered by Bergenheim. Down low, Bates can't snap the backhander off. Good defensive work by Petrovitsky. Bates has it again. Now to Hunter. Nice move. Shoot, save made. Rebound. Nurminen is stopped, or at least Nurminen stops Bergenheim, who is in close himself. And it's pitched out of the zone by Cowan and the Islanders, creating some good chances there. 6:09 to go in the second. Inema eluding Aubin. Bates hustling ahead. Trying to squeeze by Big Majewski. Hunter with a good hit. Exelby, the defenseman, has lost his stick. And Exelby, number two, he's guarded Exelby. He'll have a chance to go pick it up. Play starts the other way. Drive by Lassard, and that's steered into the corner. Pietro.
He looks frustrated, like he can't see it. And he's shaking his head after the play. I mean, he's got to fight through.
Trent Hunter from center ice has tied it 3-3. They won't review that one.
Everybody's shaking their heads. DiPietro's shaking his head because he can't see the shots. Nurminen is shaking his head because he just let in a 90-footer. Did that hit something? I think it hit something. It's just a long shot, and I think maybe not. Maybe it just skipped on it. Either way, it's got to be stopped. Let's see if it hits a defenseman. Now, Nurminen might have been anticipating that the puck was going to be shot in around the boards, because for some reason, he was way over on the right side.
3-on-2 develops for the Islanders. Parrish shoots, save Nurminen, and you want to get rubber in a goaltender as soon as possible after giving up the goal. Like Skyline at the Wachovia Center for the first meeting this season between the Islanders and the Philadelphia Flyers. And this one starts with a bit of news from an Islanders standpoint, as Mike Milbury has informed Jason Weimer that he's going to be moved, whether it's via a trade or a waiver pickup. Jason Weimer no longer a New York Islander, Joe.
No, he's not. He's not here with the team. Didn't practice yesterday, and I had a chance to talk to him tonight, Howie, before all this, and he feels bad that he's no longer with the team. Still not sure what's going to happen. He might end up in Bridgeport if no one picks him up off the waiver wire. But he's one less player who I thought had played his role. But when you look at this team, there's some kids that have stepped up and played very well, and that was one of the big decisions as to why he's not here.
And of course, the locker room always has to react when a veteran player is taken off of the roster. Michael Pekka says they'll take care of themselves just fine.
Well, it doesn't change what our jobs are. Our jobs are still to play the best we can and win hockey games, obviously. Whether the guy gets traded or whatever the situations are, and the decisions that are made by management and ownership, it's not always fun to go through, but it doesn't change what our jobs are, and it's a responsibility for the players in there to still play hard and win games.
Business-wise, that those sort of things happen, it's out of our hands as far as the players go. I mean, that's a management call. We have to put it behind us. We're going to miss him for sure. Jason was a great guy and a good friend, and it's something that we have to put it behind us and move on.
I think Jason Weimer was a good hockey player and a good guy in the locker room, and it's just unfortunate that he was a part of the business that's going on, and there's nothing we can do about it. The decision made above our head, we got to live with.
Well, it's unfortunate that had to happen. Things happen in pro sports for a reason, and I don't know the reason why that happened, but we have to come together as a team. Weems was a vocal leader in the locker room, and he was a great guy. I'm sure a lot of guys he was well liked, and a lot of guys would miss him. And I'm one of those guys, and I hated to see him go, but in the same token, we have a job to do tonight, and I think our team has to come together.
Notice the sweat there on Jason Blake's T-shirt. That is after a workout this morning that will, in fact, result in his return to the lineup tonight.
When you think about that game Saturday
Welcome
night.
Back to Geico Islanders game night as we go behind the bench with Islanders coach Steve Sterling. And here you are, a little more than a month now into your first National Hockey League season as a head coach. And you've got your first little internal challenge with Mike Milbury having told Jason Weimer that he plans to move him. And what has that done to the chemistry of the team, and what have you had to do to manage that?
Well, we've had to talk about it first and foremost because it affects, 20 guys 20 different ways. There's some that are real close to Weems and some that aren't and some in between. And some are worried about today, some are worried about tomorrow, some are worried about next week. So it really is time heals and everyone processes a little bit differently and we gave them the time to do that, but the task at hand is tonight.
What do you do though? Do you talk to them as a group or do you call certain players in who might be somewhat closer to him than others and give your side of it?
Well, no, I spend most of the time talking with the team as a group so that they could process it, and I know as a group they talked, which is important to me as the veteran guys to put it out on the table. And then individually, obviously, I spend some time with guys that I think might be helpful to me, more to me, to find out what I can do to help. It's I feel helpless at times, but I do know that I have a job at hand. And so individual meetings, and I spend a lot of time with some of the younger kids. This might be the first time they've been through it, so that may be confusing to them. So I did spend a little time with the young guys yesterday.
All right, Saturday. Weimer tonight before the game and asked him how he felt. Of course, he doesn't feel good about not being a part of the team anymore. And the one thing that really bothers him, though, were some of the quotes in the paper, or a quote in the paper, supposedly from a player that he didn't get along with this guy and that guy. And he says, I absolutely don't believe that. And talking to the players, they all felt the same way, that there was none of that in the papers. And I'll say this about Jason Weimer. And I've talked to coaches that have coached him and other teams, Mike Keenan and Brian Sutter and a lot of other people, and they've talked nothing short of a guy with great heart, a great teammate, a leader, someone that comes to play all the time. And is he the highest scoring player around? No, but he gives you an awful lot. And I'd take him on my team any day. And this is, I think, has more to do with business, and certainly it has to do with some of the things that were said, which I think were totally...
Brought to you by BMW.
Now, both teams came out hitting, actually, Howie. First, the Islanders. There's Bootenshaw with a good hit on LaPointe. O'Coin comes up with a good hit. And then Recchi, a little bit of his own. But both teams didn't pass up the opportunity to hit and to hit hard. And that's the way the first period was played. Now the Islanders had the first real good chance to score. This on the power play. Tchaikovsky to Yashin. And Yashin goes off the post with it. And then it's...
We got Finn Jansen in the penalty box for a hooking. He was trying to cover Pekka right in front of the net, but he covered him a little bit too much, I guess. Go back and take a look at it. You see Pekka right there. He's trying to get to the net. I'm not so sure, though, that Fedoric was maybe doing as much hooking on Pekka as Jansen was interfering with him.
Well, it hasn't been a tea party out there tonight.
It's been a tough game. It's been a great game.
It's been a tough game along the boards. And now Yashin, Tchaikovsky, and Kovacher on the power play. O'Coin! Oh, it hits the post! No! That is in! That was in and out so fast. Adrian O'Coin has tied it up. Wow! Took him 4 seconds on the power play to tie this one up. What a bullet from O'Coin.
And no doubt they will review that just to make absolute sure. But right from the face-off, there's the shot, and what a bullet it was.
Oh, baby.
Right in and right out. Right from the win on the draw. A nice little pass, and what a great shot.
That's even hard to see in slow motion.
So you can't expect...
Set up by Blake. And just missed. And then on the power play, the Islanders face off. One quick pass. And O'Coin blasts one past the goaltender.
Milbury's thoughts from this afternoon, this statement that he issued. And Mike Milbury said, we know we'll miss Jason. This was a practical business decision. And to answer the question as to why we didn't make this move over the summer, he had two reasons. For starters, we view Jason as a valuable asset, but the offseason saw little player movement with the uncertain economic situation around the league. And just as importantly, the maturation of some of our players this season has forced our hand to find them some playing time. The general manager went on to say, Jason is a real pro who comes to work every night. We wish him the best, and we're certain he'll be an integral part of the Minnesota Wild. So that's from the general manager, Mike Milbury, and that situation seems resolved as Jason Weimer is headed to the Minnesota Wild.
Roman Hamrelick hit by Bejan, number 22. That's Steve Bejan, pick up in the waiver draft from Buffalo. And an Eric Goddard dump in produces a chase. Leon gets there first. Mapletoff finished his check. Bergenheim to Mapletoff. He was hoping to find Goddard, but that was knocked down by the stick of Rive.
Now, you notice that last dump in? That's not what Steve Sterling wants his team to do, to dump it in softly. He wants the puck to go hard around the glass or hard around the boards to create a one-on-one situation on the other side. He says that's the only way they can try and get the puck back.
Nice play by Martinik at the line. Score! Kavasha! It all started with a good play from Radek Martinik, and then the long drive by Kavasha gives the Islanders a 1-0 lead.
Now Theodore wishes he had that one back. Martinik made the play, and then that forced Montreal to back in. There's the play by Martinik, and now they can't have all their players back, so there's time, and here's the shot. And it looked like it went off, pardon me, it, one of those that got deflected, went off the stick of the defenseman, Suri, and deflected it past his goaltender. I thought Theodore just missed it. My apologies there, it was off the stick and deflected in past him.
So for Kavasha, his fifth of the year, and the Islanders have the 1-0 lead. First goal, they finally get past Theodore in a game and a half a period. Yashin in over the line.
Teammates broken up, are able to clear it. But then Martinik was just back in the line. Look at the defensive play. Beautiful play at his own blue line. The Islanders quickly go the other way. The long shot by Kavasha. Watch it hit the stick of the defenseman, Sheldon Surre. And that deflects past Theodore for the 1-0 lead. They almost made it 2-0 shorthanded when Jason Blake, coming in from the right side, put it off the crossbar and over the glass.
Part about that interview was getting Yashin to admit that he's happier this year. I know we could all see it.
He doesn't say a lot.
He does not like to talk about himself,
no,
does he?
You can see it. I mean, you could tell by the look in his eye the first day that I saw him anyway this year, and you could just tell he felt better about things.
Mark Parrish trying to squeeze through Surre, couldn't do it. Johnson for Asham. Brisebois on Asham. And Brisebois got a stick down, but Pekka got it in front. They score! Mark Parrish gives the Islanders a 2-1 lead.
His favorite spot. The Islanders are able to make the play at center ice and get the puck in. Away they go. They carry it in this time. And Parrish, of course, is around the front of the net. Pekka just throws it there. Parrish finds it. Sheldon Surre was there, but Parrish was able to get better position. And then just a quick shot. See, Surre got caught on the wrong side of the puck. He should have kept himself between Parrish and his goaltender. And went past Parrish, and he's got those good hands around the net. Nice to see him finally touch a puck around the net. He hasn't had it much, has he?
I was going to say, the chances, never mind the goals. He'd only had one in his last 11 games before that, but the chances had been few and far between. Janssen a drive, gloved up high by Theodore. Right? I mean, how many times can you remember Parrish even having a scoring chance?
You know, part of the problem for Mark Parrish is that the Islanders, all their center icemen, are right-handed shots. And you tend to go to your forehand if you're a passer. You tend to pass to your forehand and not your backhand. For Parrish to get the puck, Pekka has to go to his backhand to make the pass.
And now Hunter to Bates. And he might have hit the post with that. Certainly hit something headed for the far side.
Yeah, I think the puck was on edge, and he just shanked it wide and hit a defenseman's leg.
Now Rive
finds Dackel for the shot and the tying goal. Hunter had four shots on goal in the second period. That one hit the post. That didn't count. And Gar Snow was very busy in goal for the Islanders. Here's another long shot, another good chance on the rebound by Trent Hunter. And that was stopped. And eventually the Islanders take a 2-1 lead. Michael Pekka will end up with the puck here. Just throws it in front. Mark Parrish finds it. And those quick hands of Mark Parrish gets a shot underneath the goaltender, Jose Theodore, and the Islanders.
Up nice from Stanley Cup winning goal in 1980. And it's not just the puck going into the net. It's a panoramic look at the Coliseum as it
history.
Looked. Yeah, it looked a little different back then. Different scoreboard. A little bit different feel to the
wonderful
building.
Wonderful piece of Long Island history.
That's right. Right now, this game a minute 40 away from becoming history. Sean Bates lofts one in over the Montreal line. Asham gives chase, centers Hunter, written by Rive. 3-on-3 the other way. Canadiens led here by Judel for Bajan. And that drive missed upstairs. Down to a minute 24 to go. Canadiens will look to get Theodore to the bench. Markov at his own blue line. Missed Koivu with the initial pass. Koivu reaches back forward, a minute 12 left. But in comes Perreault. Yannick Perreault, a shot. A save by Snow. Theodore goes out. Puck pitched all the way down. It'll cost the Islanders an icing, though. So Theodore goes to the bench. But icing called against the Islanders, and they'll leave Theodore on the bench in all likelihood with the draw in the Islanders' zone and set up the 6-on-5.
Yeah, Perreault with a good play here. Watch a little move, and then he'll try to use the defenseman as a screen, and he shoots right through the legs of Ninema, and Gar Snow, with good concentration, makes the save, and then the Islanders, not a bad job there to ice it. That line had been out there for quite a while, and they're able to change lines.
Another big face-off win for Pekka. That's 13 out of 19 now, including 8 out of 11 in his own end. So he's been dominant on the draws, and we're into the final minute. And just winning that face-off alone took about 20 seconds off the clock. And now with the open end, here's Jason Blake from Bates. In on the empty net, and he scores! To do with the ultimate empty netter.
Now, Michael Pekka has gotten stronger as this game has gone on. You mentioned the faceoffs defensively, also assisted on the second goal, and was there to try and force things in the neutral zone before Adrian O'Coin just off the glass. And Pekka forced a play, O'Coin gets it out, Bates knocks it down, and then just gives it to Blake.
Nice unselfish play by Sean Bates.
Yep.
Although who knows what Blake might have been threatening him with as he was trailing him down the ice. Sean Bates plays it in behind the net with 26 seconds to go. But you know what? Blake deserved one tonight, whether there was a goaltender in there or not.
He sure did.
So the Islanders about to win for the 8th time this year. As Jason Blake picks up his 5th goal into the empty net. Kenny Janssen back at his own blue line. Finds Bates at center. And the New York Islanders have defeated the Montreal Canadiens by the score of 3-1. They tie the Vancouver Canucks for the most home ice wins in the National Hockey League. It's their 7th. And this was one that just about everybody, I think, had a piece of.
Yeah, you know what? This was a game where the Islanders did not play well in the second period. They let the game get away from them a little bit, but good teams are able to turn things around and get back to what they were doing. Gar Snow was solid in goal for the Islanders, and the Islanders in the third period played well defensively. They got the goals that they needed, and as a team, they really came together to get the win.
So the Islanders, 3-1 winners tonight, Bates and O'Coin. O'Coin had another big plus night, plus 3. Pick up the assists on the empty netter at 19-19. Islanders defeat the Canadiens 3-1. Right now, though, we're going to send you back to our MSG Network. Brought to you by Bud Light, proud supporter of the NHL.
Yeah, it was so important because Montreal had really come on in the second period. They put a lot of pressure on and tied the game. And then towards the end of the second period is when Pekka was able to get the puck from Masham, throw it to the front of the net. And there was Mark Parrish, who was so good around the front of the net. He slides the puck underneath the pads of Jose Theodore, and that made it.
All right, enough pucks to go around for the Islanders as they beat Montreal tonight. Kenny Janssen and Roman Hamrlik were just two of the defensemen that had stellar games. Yanni Nenema took a hit, and it was the Canadiens who took a hit in the end. Jason Blake got the empty netter. Another great night for the Kavasha, Yashin, Trakotsky line. The Blake Bates line, Gar Snow played well. Everybody played well. Martinik got his first assist of the year. And we will see you from Music City Saturday night at 8. It's the Islanders and Predators, and Howie and Joe are paying for dinner. Game night starts at 7:30. Thanks to my guys Kevin and Larry, Charlie and Pete. We'll see you again on Saturday night. Thanks so much. I'm Deb Coffin from the Coliseum. The Islanders win again. Lucky 7 at home. Best damn sports show period is next.
Hey, Jose Theodore. He's not impressed, and here's why. It goes off off Shure's stick, and Kavasha gets the goal. That's his 5th of the year, by the way. Second period, Andreas Dackel, working hard, gets hauled down in front, gets back up, quick little one-timer. Nice pass by Mike Ribeiro. That ties things up. Theodore, trying to keep it that way, stops Adrian Acoin. Then Trent Hunter, two big saves shortly after that, though. Mike Pekka to Mark Parrish. And Parrish will sweep it past Theodore. Parrish just outworks Surrey as he slides away at the side of the net. That's his fifth. That makes it 2-1. Third period. Jason Blake wallpapered by Surrey, but he would get his revenge. On the forecheck, he drills him. Surrey, yeah, he's going to feel that one. Later in the third, with the net empty, Blake's going to seal it. His fifth of the year. Islanders win it 3-1. They are unbeaten in their last five home meetings with the Montreal Canadiens. Adrian Acoin, 6 points in his last six games. Mike Ribeiro, by the way, hasn't scored a goal in 13 games. He did pick up a helper in this contest.
Shout-out to Blue Jets. Season first period halves with some pressure. Craig Reveille with a point shot. He goes postal with it. And that seemed to spark the Islanders a little bit. They got a lucky break. Alexei Yashin looking for Oleg Tavasha. And you got a good look at it. Theodore didn't. And it was 1-0 New York. Islanders looking for more off the rush. Jason Blake, for goodness sake, he's got a hard shot. Did you hear that beautiful noise? It hits the crossbar. That's always a beautiful noise for the goaltenders. Anyway, second period halves on the forecheck with Barrel. Centering pass to Andreas Dackel. The Dekelian one, as Don Taylor would call him. His third, and the game is tied at one. At the other end, Mike Pekka throws it at the net. Parrish the thought, but it's true. Mark Parrish is there. Five-hole past Theodore. Obviously not wearing those cheaters that Darren Millard wears at Wednesday Sports and Hockey between his legs. 2-1 New York. Habs get sloppy. Blake beating Surrey to the pocket alone. Hold the phone. Theodore going to make the big-time save. Theodore made 23 saves. He was pretty good tonight, but the story is he's not good enough. The snowman made hugs from everybody. All the kids love to hug the snowman. And the Islanders defeat Montreal 3-1. Do you care to comment on the cheater comment that I made just a moment ago?
No, but my attorney will be in touch with you. That's slanderous.
All right, I look forward to that. The Canadians now winless in their last five trips to Long Island. Islanders, though, win for the first time in three games.
You scored two goals for the first time in 3 years.
$1.6 million salary. Wild pick the forward up off waivers today. More than willing to absorb the cost of a well-liked player in that Islander locker room. Weimer had 4 points in 13 games with New York.
First period, Oleg Kovacic, big slapper, beats Jose Theodore. Theodore not impressed. Why? Well, at the right of your screen, Surrey's stick deflects Kovacic's shot. His fifth opens the scoring. Second period action, Andreas Dackel gets hauled down in front, gets back up. One time the centering attempt by Mike Ribeiro, his second ties things at one. Theodore trying to keep it that way. Stops Adrian Acoin from the point. Trent Hunter's on the rebound. Two big stops, keeping this game tied. Shortly after, however, Mike Pekka feeds Mark Parrish, sweeps it past Theodore. Watch how he outworks Surrey to the net. His fifth puts the Isles up 2-1. Surrey, a quick minus two, showing shame. Third period, Jason Blake leveled by Surrey, but he would get his revenge on the forecheck, lines him up. Surrey's feeling it on the bench afterwards. Tough night for Surrey. Late in the third, net's empty. Blake seals the deal. Fifth on the year, the Isles win at 3-1 the final. Islanders are unbeaten in their last five home meetings with the Canadians, 4-0-1. Adrian Acoin, 6 points in his last six games.
It has not been a real strong supply on the road compared to how they've played at home, and that's a concern that he's got.
Yeah, exactly right. He wants them to start playing, as you said, with more of that on the road, and he thinks they'll start winning a little bit more on the road.
Nice deflection by Ninema right into the Islander bench.
Now, Steve Sterling, you know, it was interesting yesterday. Steve Sterling called a meeting with Mike Milbury, the general manager, and Charles Wong, the co-owner of the team. And they had a meeting yesterday morning before practice, and they were actually late going out for practice. And the players, they were in with the coaches, and the players were on the ice without the coaches. They were thinking that a big trade was going down. And Steve Sterling called the meeting with Mike Milbury and with Charles Wong to say to them, listen, how about if we just settle down on the talk? It's something that's hanging over these players. I think it's affecting our team on trade talk I'm talking about. And he says, how about if we just leave everything alone for the time being and let us play? And it'll, you know, give the players a little bit of a release from what's going on. And Mike Milbury and Charles Wong said, fine. Go on the road trip. Tell the players, listen, everybody's going to be there. Everybody will return home from the road trip. Don't worry about the things that have been in the paper and things that are coming out of Chicago, which there have been a few articles. And so they agreed with him. And that was, you know, I think it was good of him to get everything settled down. So he told the players this morning, don't worry about getting traded.
That's pretty impressive for a first-year coach to take that kind of initiative with a general manager and the owner.
Well, he's got such a, you know, he's so in touch with his players from a communication standpoint. And he knows exactly when something starts going a little haywire and there's something that's bothering the players. And again, you talk to the players. I did talk to some of the players. They were skating around yesterday morning waiting for someone to come out of that meeting that was an impromptu type meeting to say, all right, you're traded, somebody head off the ice. And of course, a lot of the talk has been regarding Mark Parrish. But Steve Sterling was, I think he made a smart move, and Mike Milbury and Charles Wong listened to their coach.
They get at least five more, and they're trading haymakers. Brookbank with a couple of right hands. Goddard answered with a left. Brookbank a left before Goddard puts him down.
You knew that was just a matter of time. That's Fighting Major number 26 on the year for the Nashville Predators.
And for Garth Snow, that'll be his, or for Eric Goddard, pardon me, that'll be his fifth. Wednesday night, more NHL action here on Metro TV. Devils and Sabres, with Devils game night starting it off at 7, and then game time at 7:30 Wednesday night here on Metro. But Brookbank and Goddard in a predictable fight, each get 5.
Yeah. He was picked up on waivers, correct? Right at the
from Ottawa.
During training camp?
How about that, though? This was his second shift of the game. He was on and off the ice just like that in the first period, so he's played a little over 30 minutes this season, and now he's got 38 penalty minutes.
He's going to break Gretzky's 50 goals in 39 games. Oh, no, that was a different record.
Yeah, something different. So, on-ice manpower not affected by the five-minute fighting majors that cancel each other out. Bergenheim for the Islanders got it out of the zone. Brookbank made his presence immediately felt in his NHL debut. He had 2 fights, 14 penalty minutes. Just wanted everybody to know he was in the league.
We found out
in a hurry. And here we go on the second event of tonight's card. It is Jim McKenzie, who once went to training camp with the Islanders, against Eric Cairns. And McKenzie throwing short rights. Now with his left hand, McKenzie not really scoring there as Cairns grabs hold of McKenzie. Now with a big right hand, he's hit the back of his helmet more than anything else. But now McKenzie, without the helmet, starting to throw. And I think they're out of gas.
That's it. That's enough. That's enough. Have you had enough? Yes, so have I. See you later.
Boy.
Jim McKenzie signed here as a free agent after, of course, winning the Stanley Cup with the Devils last year. And he could have re-signed there, and he could have re-signed at a number of other places. And checked this place out and thought this would be a good place to come and help the young kids. And I'll tell you what, they threw him with lefts and rights and lefts and rights, and finally...
There's no bell here.
And now...
they have the points. This is Zidlitsky. Timonen. Waiting straight away. The shot blocked. Ninema trying to clear. Couldn't do it.
And the defense switched sides now so they can take the shot, I believe, off the pass. Timonen and Zidlitsky.
Zidlitsky a one-timer. That's tipped wide. Ninema off the boards but not out. Zidlitsky. Fake the pass. Now across to Hall. And Legwon gets it back. 18 to the two-man power play. Legwon. Zidlitsky in the circle. To the slot. He shoots. Glove save Snow. He juggles it. And now Snow gets involved. The puck dribbles into the net. The red light had gone on. And now more pushing and shoving. Garth Snow's right in the middle of it.
You've got Hartnell, who's big and strong. And you've got Hall, that's big and strong. And you've got just 3 Islanders on the ice and 5. And Garth Snow was being crowded on the play. And then Hammerlick end up with a cross check. I believe it was on Hall that knocked him into Garth Snow, who then reacted. And Garth Snow, all he needed was a reason. He'll get a reason right here. You can see Hall jump in there. Hartnell and everybody gets together. And we'll see what happens on these calls. I think Snow trying to get his teammates going as well.
Now they're over at the scores table. The Fire red light had gone. But that hit a leg, and Bergenheim carries it out into the Nashville zone. Bergenheim off the side of the net as he worked on Zidlitsky. And we're down to 3:20 to go in the second period. Tutu is on the ice right now, just had the stick knocked out of his hand.
So is Goddard.
Well, Tutu heading off with 3:08 to go in the period. Bergenheim softly up the left wing. Icing waved off, so here's Goddard in on Wade Brookbank, number 26. And a feed by Orsog, rink wide, too far for Murray to handle. So Eric Cairns gets it back. Now Goddard heads off, and here's a lead for Cherkovsky on a breakaway. He shoots, he scores! Marius Cherkovsky puts the Islanders on the board with his 11th goal of the year, and the Nashville lead is cut to 3-1.
That's a beautiful pass from Yanni Nenema at his own blue line to spring Cherkovsky, who cut right through the middle. Cherkovsky finds the opening, beautiful pass, and then protects the puck and the quick shot. The goaltender, Vokoun, hasn't been tested much in this game. Look at that pass on the tape. Watch him protect the puck and then the quick shot. And Marius Cherkovsky continues his fine play. Better than fine, isn't it? Goal number 11.
He was in a downright slump. He had gone two in a row without one.
Great shot there. Beautiful pass. The Islanders right back in this.
Johnson on defense here.
And Goddard on the ice again against Wade Brookbank.
Oh, Brookbank, yep. Wade Brookbank.
Tough kid. They had a fight in the second period.
Goddard just skated past him. And in the meantime, back come the Predators. A save by Snow, and the rebound pushed wide. Shot from the blue line, knocked away. Remember the old chili promotion that the Islanders used to have going with Wendy's at the Coliseum over 20 years ago? Well, they've got something similar here. It's tacos from Taco Bell if the Predators get to 5 goals. So every time a Predator has the puck, the crowd starts salivating. They want to chew. And here comes Mapletoft. He shoots, he scores! Justin Mapletoft with his first goal of the year. And the Nashville lead is back down to 2. It's 4-2 Predators.
Well, if he worked on his offense, it showed on this one. He reaches behind him and throws the puck behind him and then retrieves it as he gets the pass at the blue line. Now, it was a beautiful play. He's coming across the blue line, and watch him right at the blue line. Look it, puts it behind him and goes and gets it all in one motion. And then the quick shot just inside the post. That's a terrific play by Mapletoft. Beautiful play. Islanders back to within a couple goals and still 10-11 to play in the game.
That might keep Brookbank and Goddard dreaming about another engagement somewhere down the road, longer this game stays close.
For a few minutes.
So, 10 minutes to go in the third. 4-2, but back come the Predators. Snow, a save on Johnson. Rick Johnson with a pretty good shot. And now Michael Pekka exchanged shoves with Tutu and knocked the stick out of his hand. Meantime, Parrish drives to the net but misses the short side. O'Coin can't keep it there, and it travels all the way down. Mapletoft's first from Hamerlich and O'Coin at the 8:43 mark of the third period. But a steal, Hall, back to the blue line. Zidlitsky's shot knocked away by Garth Snow as they continue to yell, "We want tacos."
Wait till they find out it's raw fish.
Had them haul from a, you mean that's what they do with those catfish?
they've been putting them in the refrigerator.
We're going to use them, whether they like it or not.
You think we just get rid of these sticky
that's
fish,
right.
Do you? You get one of these fish sandwiches with a little fries on the side as well.
Well, on the chewy side, you'll understand. Zidlitsky floats one ahead.
Oh, boy.
Of course, Tutu was joking about that stuff. He says, well, I'm used to eating raw fish. Eric Cairns in the corner in the Islanders' zone, but now time becoming more of a factor. 8:34 remaining in the Islanders, 2 goals down. Yanni Nenema up the middle, lofted towards Bates, left back the other way, and it's Cairns for Ninema. Martin Irad challenging Ninema, forcing him into that quick pass. Hunter is back, though, trying to turn away from the check of Orsog, and Trent Hunter just does get it out of the zone. Eric Cairns for Cherkovsky. And Yashin heads towards the corner. But the puck picked off. The Predators come to center, led by Rem Murray. Snow winds it around. Mapletoft station four. Mapletoft to Yashin. Now for Asham. He steps up, shoots, he scores! Aaron Asham! And it's 4-3 Nashville with 7:41 to go in the third.
Yeah, Yashin with a couple of new line mates. Yashin getting a lot of ice time here. And Aaron Asham on the wing with Yashin gets the goal. He put that one right through the pads of the goaltender Bokun. Yashin takes the puck right here. Look at him. He settles the puck down, holds it, and then just throws it off the other side. Gets everybody going one way, throws it to Asham, who was going the other way, and Asham, who's got a good shot, let it go there. Steve Sterling's been telling him, shoot the puck. Shoot the puck more. He did there. The Islanders suddenly within a goal. Look at that pass. Just a chip. And Asham with the quick shot. Bokun didn't look ready. He only got a piece of it. The Islanders within a goal at 4-3.
Ole Jokinen bounces one behind the net. DiPietro out to get it. Went off a Florida skate, but right to Yashin. And Alexei Yashin starts ahead. Yashin moving well. Now pulls up and looks for help. Throws it down low, but that's broken up at the defense by Van Rijn. Jokinen for Hagman into the Islander zone. And a glove save by DiPietro.
That's been interesting. Every time DiPietro handles the puck, the Florida players just go right to the boards. Meanwhile, look at Novoseltsev in the speed. In the pass, and there's Messier, who somehow was able to get his stick around O'Coin to redirect it. And that's a good first save by DiPietro to get him in the game.
It's set up by some of that speed you were talking about with Novoseltsev. So DiPietro, his only loss came in his last start, and that was in the game the Islanders led Atlanta 2-0, but wound up losing 4-3.
Now, another player to keep an eye on this game is Vaclav Nedorov. He's the player that was acquired from Colorado in the offseason. Remember the Peter Worrell trade? They also got Messier in that deal. And he's just back in the lineup, and he is flying. He's a tremendous, tremendous skater. Scored a spectacular goal against Atlanta on Sunday night, their last game.
Trent Hunter for the Islanders sends it behind the Florida net. Jason Blake takes a hit from Biron. Blake keeps working the legs. Now to Bates. Bates was checked by Weiss. Neither of them saw the puck initially as it skitters to the far side. And something just popped out.
It looks like a lens.
And a backhander score! And the Islanders take the lead as Hunter, Bates, and Blake combine to put New York in front with a lens on the ice.
Yeah, I think it was Hunter that's going to get credit for this, as that lens was on the ice. Cairns gets the puck through, and there it is. Yeah, he gets credit for it. Blake was in the crease. It doesn't matter if he was in the crease. He didn't touch it. And Hunter is able to get his stick on. That's a great job by Hunter. As Lyle Oldline was all over Hunter. You see the reach on Hunter? That's what makes him good. He's strong, and he's got that long reach. So even though he was being defended, he could still reach and get the puck and get a shot at the same time.
So the Islanders grabbed the lead. Trent Hunter had gone a few games without a point, but that's his seventh goal of the year. And now Mapletoft working behind the net. Center's got it, a shot. And Luongo made a save as Goddard got it off while being taken down. Now Papineau tries to center. Goddard was tied up by Lilia. Hammerlick flings it at the net. And a save by Luongo. Goddard working the corner. Gets a little help there. Richard from... scores! Matthias Demander was the last to know about it. He just threw it at the net from inside the blue line. We'll see if that was redirected, but either way, it gives the Islanders a 2-1 lead.
You know, Howie, if this wasn't redirected, then certainly Luongo was screened, but it looked to me like it changed direction about 20 feet in front. They win the faceoff, which is important, and it's just a wrist shot. And did it hit somebody? It might have hit one of the Florida defensemen and then redirected in. Here's another look at it. Hard to tell, again, from that angle, but Tamander with the shot, just get it on the net and see what happens.
So Matthias Tamander playing in his first NHL game of the year.
didn't have a goal in Bridgeport, did he?
Oh, yeah.
Four assists.
And was starting to play a little bit better after, by his own admission, a very difficult start. Just getting adjusted from a mindset standpoint to being in the American League.
Well, I talked to Greg Cronin, who coaches Bridgeport. I talked to him last night, and we talked about Matias Demander, and he said the one thing about him is that he had a great attitude playing in the minor leagues. He was very good with the younger players on the team and accepted his role and worked hard. Even though things didn't go real well for him early, he kept working hard and didn't complain about the fact that he wasn't up with the big team. That's a good start for the Islanders. Good shot as they lead it by one.
Here's Matias Demander's goal as he wristed it in from just inside the blue line, squeezing it through some traffic. And the Islanders regain the lead. Branislav Meze carries in deep. He's a defenseman. Now Jokinen with a little room. Save made by DiPietro, and then it's batted wide. Now Kozlov lost it to Yashin, who finds Tchaikovsky.
That was Yashin that batted the puck out of midair into the corner to get it away from the front of the net.
Kavasha away from Meze. Kavasha locks his man up. That let Tchaikovsky get to the puck. Now to O'Coin. He shoots, didn't get through it, hit Yashin, and is recovered and cleared out by Hagman. Brought on now by Jokinen. Jokinen with Kozlov, and Hagman drops to Hagman. He's in for a backhander and a save, and then a second save on Kozlov by DiPietro. Bomeister lets one go. Gruff save, DiPietro. And Rick DiPietro, very active there, having to stop several shots, including a couple from close in.
You know, the Islanders had three players back, but no one saw Hagman. Hagman made the play from right about his own blue line and then just joined the play. Where is he? All of a sudden, he shows up there, and Kenny Johnson was going across with Jokinen, and then Hagman had that chance, made this, and DiPietro with a good save on the back end, then made a second save as well.
4.5 to go in the period. Islanders up 2-1. Parrish turns it
line almost strictly in a defensive role, especially for all those home games. And he'd like to get a little more offense out of that.
Well, Pekka just about got through. There'll be a penalty shot. A penalty shot for Michael Pekka as he was trying to get through the defense. He got a step, was pulled down, and Michael Pekka will go one-on-one with Roberto Luongo.
Well, he wanted offense. How about this? The pass right up the middle. Here goes Pekka in the clear. Hook from behind. That's the right call. And so the Islanders, 2:06 to go in this first period. And Michael Pekka looking for his third goal of the season. He'll go against Luongo.
It'll be the 11th penalty shot this season. Three have been successful. Here is Pekka, one-on-one with Luongo. Pekka is stopped by Roberto Luongo.
Now, Michael Pekka looked like he faked the forehand, then faked the backhand and tried to go back to the forehand and kind of lost control of it. And Luongo's there with just a cover-up watch. Fake, backhand, and then as he tried to get it back to the forehand again, Luongo with the stick. Watch the stick right here. He was in so tight that Luongo was just able to use the stick to poke the puck. Start to the first period, and they got that. They got their forecheck going. They were putting pressure on the Panthers in their zone. And then Hunter with this rebound shot in to pass
the game.
And a goal apiece. Matias Demander, his first game this season as an Islander. Off the faceoff, watch the wrist shot go through. Big Eric Goddard was in front providing the screen, and Demander's shot made it a 2-1 game. Well, Michael Pekka had this opportunity. Didn't get a shot on the breakaway, was pulled down. That's a penalty shot, and here's the effort by Pekka. Tried to stick handle past Luongo. Luongo gets his stick on the puck, preventing a shot.
Pekka, and the Islanders centering Parrish and Tchaikovsky. And again, Yashin's going to play the point here with Hamrlik.
Well, you know what? When we saw Yashin playing the point at the end of that first period, when he got the puck with time, he was taking the shot. I think that's what Steve Sterling wants. He wants more shots. That tells me he's not happy with the other players, the other defense that have been on the power play.
38 seconds left to this power play for the Islanders as Yashin brings it in. Double team, so he finds Parrish. All the way to the blue line now. Roman Hamrlik challenged by Weiss. Pekka behind the net. Back towards the blue line. Hamrlik to Yashin. A drive, and that missed the net. Hard shot by Yashin. Here he is again. Now for Pekka. 16 to the power play. Pekka, cross ice feed. Lands on Hamrlik's stick. Parrish to Pekka. looks for help at the blue line, but shanked the pass.
Now, the other interesting thing is that Parrish and Pekka have been on the third power play unit. The third power play unit, and they're getting plenty of power play time tonight.
Hamerlich's drive stopped by Luongo. The rebound to Hunter. Penalty is over. Team's at full strength. Trent Hunter took it from Bates. Now O'Coin throws it at the net. It's tipped. They score! Sean Bates, I believe, made the tip high in the slot around the hash marks, and the Islanders take a 3-1 lead.
That was just an innocent-looking play. And again, O'Coin, all he does is he's getting the puck at the net. Bullmister number 4 was there for Florida as well. And the Islanders just getting the shot. Let's see, did it hit Bullmister? Oh, you were right, Howie. Bates, and then went straight down and then bounced up. I mean, Bates does a good job. He's here. Now watch him knock it down, and then it just bounces straight up. And Luongo, I think, was screened by Bullmister on the play. Talk about a perfect deflection. That was it. Why are they calling upstairs? Is there some question as to the height?
The play is under
possibly a high stick. Well, I think it was only a foot and a half off the ice, maybe 2 feet off the ice. Let's see where it is. Bates gets to the middle. It's up high, but see, no. He goes straight down. I mean, that puck wasn't more than a foot and a half off the ice. The stick started up high over his shoulder, but you saw the stick come down, and by the time it made contact with the puck couldn't have been more than a foot and a half or 2 feet off the ice.
Yeah, the criteria is on the other coast in Florida, and that's Al Arbor.
You know what? And I talked to Scotty Bowman about Al. He saw him. Al's not feeling all that well, so we send our best to him and hope that he gets better.
Hashem was taken down at the corner, went back at Lilia. But now
Hashem had to reach back for it. I'm not sure if he just didn't miss it or if it bounced over his stick.
Roussalius made a move at the line. They keep it onside. DiPietro challenges, and Lilia's shot was knocked away. Now Ninema got it around to Kavasha, and up comes Cherkovsky working on Lilia. Now he has Cherkovsky, finally gets around him, and then his pass was deflected by Yashin. Yashin, strong on the puck, finally bumped off of it. And Roussalius gives it away with 2.5 to go in the second period. Any time or the other, on the
comes
Florida
Biron.
Panther. Matthew Biron trying to weave through some traffic. Jokinen, angled by Janssen. Following, though, is Weiss. Steven Weiss down low. Kozlov, DiPietro down. Kozlov hits him with it. Kozlov could not get that puck up high enough at first. And now a centering feed deflects towards Kozlov. 9 seconds left. He throws it at the net. Chipped away. Janssen's got it. And the Islanders will escape with their 2-goal lead at the end of 2 periods. Although Viktor Kozlov came very close to cutting that lead in half.
Now Kozlov did everything right. He waited because DiPietro was going down on the play. So Kozlov just waited and waited and waited. And they finally got to a point where he just couldn't lift it up high enough to get it over DiPietro. Kozlov has great hands. And Weiss is able to just throw the puck to the front. And now watch him wait. He's got time. He's got room. He's going to go to his backhand. And as it was going up high, DiPietro did a great job. Boy, he got his hands and arms up. Watch again. This might have found the top part of the net, but I think it was just DiPietro getting his stick and his arms up, stopping it from going in the top part of the net. Great save.
That's a much better save than I thought it was.
Florida tied it up 1-1. And then the Islanders with a 2-1 lead. Sean Bates on the power play. Beautiful deflection here. Luongo screened on the play. That puck bounced high over the glove of Luongo. And then a shorthanded chance by Jason Blake. Beautiful pass from Kenny Janssen. Blake goes in. Luongo might have just gotten a piece of that. And Blake is back after the knee injury, back to what he was doing so effectively prior to that. Work ethic, always around the puck, always finding open ice. And Rick DiPietro, who hadn't played in 11 days, has been sharp in this game. At times, he hasn't faced many shots. At other times, Florida has come at him with a barrage. And this one might have been his best right at the end of the second period on Victor Kozlov.
A fight breaks out. Odaline and Eric Goddard. And Goddard throwing right hands at Odaline, who gets one of his own in. Goddard ducked away from one. Now he's connecting to the back of Odaline's helmetless head. And Goddard with a big right hand. I think that one hurt Lyle Odaline. And Goddard keeps him at bay with his left and fires right hands. Boy, Goddard has one quick right hand, and Lyle Odaline just found that out. And the linesmen want them to get this out of their system, but Goddard's yelling, no, not yet.
Goddard wants to stop hitting him. I mean, Goddard's got respect for him because of all the wars that he's been in the National Hockey League. And Odeline says, no. Goddard doesn't want to hit him anymore.
Well, Odeline is able to sneak a left hand in there. And a right. Now Goddard fires with a right. He's got him off balance. And Odeline is down. Clear win for Eric Goddard.
Now, Odeline has been around a long, long time. A long time. And he's been in a lot of scraps. And he's not nearly the size of Goddard. But he's always had a big heart. He's always been willing. He's always done whatever it took for his team to try and change things around, and that's what he's trying to do here. And it got to a point, and I give Goddard credit. I mean, there's no question he was winning the fight easily, and he didn't want to hurt him. He didn't want to hurt him. There's Goddard on the ice. This is the whistle, and then they bump. And Odeline was the one that, you know, that initiated the fight. That's the kind of teammate he is, and that's why they signed him down here. He's a veteran guy and a lot of young players. And it just got to a point, I give Goddard credit too. I mean, Goddard was winning the fight handily, and then elected just to stop. He didn't want to hurt him. And Odeline, why'd he say, leave me alone? Keep going. I want to keep going.
And number two of the Panthers, Lyle Odeline.
Thank you to the National Hockey League for clarifying that.
Van Rijn drops one off, and Jokinen is stopped by Rick DiPietro.
And, of course, we were only in jest in talking about Brian Campbell, who's the video, our friend Brian Campbell. They couldn't have been taking that seriously.
No, Well, you didn't hear from him, did you?
We appreciate that.
Kozlov a drive, a save by DiPietro. Send back to the slot to Meze. He was high in the slot and didn't get that one through. Now Blake trying to scoot to the net on Meze. He angled him, and Biron finishes him. But now the Islanders get help from Bates. Works it free to Hunter. He scores! Trent Hunter with his second of the game, and the Islanders take a 4-1 lead.
And now this all starts with Jason Blake. It was a one-on-two, and Blake just kept going, and when he was angled off, he stayed with the play. Then he got some help from Bates, who then found Hunter. But it was Blake from the blue line in. Look, he's got one man here, Meze, and he tries to beat him, and then he gets the other defenseman over, so it's a one-on-two, and he stays with the puck, and then Bates comes in, and I'm sure he yelled to him to leave the puck, and then gave Hunter the pass, and Hunter, what a shot. Perfect wrist shot up high. Boy, that's just great communication, excellent hustle, and the perfect finish. And the Islanders are up 4-1.
So two more in this game for Trent Hunter, who has 8 on the season now. And the Islanders with a little breathing room here in the third as Lilia touches for an icing with 5:14 gone in this period. And not only does Hunter have 2, but he got one way up high to the neck area of Luongo, which stunned him in the second.
You know how I mentioned good communication, because when you're a player and you've got players hanging all over you, as Blake does here, watch him behind the net. Now, at that point, if he doesn't know Blake's there, you see him lift his stick so that Bates could take the puck. I mean, Bates had to yell for him to leave the puck alone because Blake couldn't see him. So he lifted his stick, allowed Bates to handle the puck.
The Islanders
and
did a lot of damage with the puck in deep. And Blake does a great job here. Archie takes 2 men, and then he'll leave the puck right there. He'll leave it for Bates, who then finds Hunter, and Hunter with a quick wrist shot up and over the shoulder of Luongo, and that turned out to be the fourth goal for the Islanders.
Trent Hunter, 2 goals. We'll come back to Florida right after these messages. Fouls all around. Matthias Tamander played his first game of the year with the Islanders. Wouldn't you know it, came up with a goal as Biron and other former Islanders like Roberto Luongo were on the short end tonight. So the Islanders, 4-1 winners. And now it's on to the St. Pete Times Forum. Our producer tonight has been Kevin Meininger. Our director has been Larry Roth. All of the replays, they were the work of G.T. Townsend. And the graphics provided by Peter McEvely. Stay tuned now for the best sports show, period. For Joe Micheletti, I'm Howie Rose. And for our entire Fox Sports Net crew, we wish you a pleasant good night.
Called up 7-year veteran Matthias Tamander from Bridgeport this morning and put him right into the
game. 5 minutes into it, Islanders get on the board. Eric Cairns shooting from the point, save, kicked out. Trent Hunter slides the puck under Roberto Luongo for the goal. Isles up 1-0. 2:30 later, Florida evens it on the power play. Valeri Bure shot deflected right to Nathan Horton. It's a power play goal. Steve Sterling not happy. But he was happier after this, off the faceoff. Teamander coming up and getting points, scoring from the point. It's a 2-1 Islander lead. Tail end of the first, Michael Pekka gets out on the breakaway. Eric Messier drags him down, and you know what that means? A penalty shot for Pekka. So it'll be Pekka going against his former teammate, Roberto Luongo. Luongo wins it. So it's 2-1 Islanders after one period. Beginning of the second, Isles try to get buzzing again. Trent Hunter. Cross ice to Adrian O'Coin. He whistles one at the net. Tipped in front and in. Who got the goal? On the replay, it shows Sean Bates knocked it straight down. Luongo never had a chance. It's Bates' fifth of the year. Isles up 3-1. 10 seconds to go in the second. Rick DiPietro on his game, stopping Victor Kozlov. Somehow, some way, it gets cleared. 5 minutes into the third, the Hunter Blake Bates line does it again. Bates takes away from Jason Blake behind the goal, feeds Trent Hunter his second of the game, and that would be enough as the Islanders get the win, 4-1 the final. Hunter scored twice. The Islanders now unbeaten in 7 games against Florida. They've also been unbeaten in their last 7 games at Florida. The ex-Islander, Roberto Luongo, stopping those 28 shots, but it was not enough because the Islanders got the victory, 4-1 the final.
All right, up next on Sports.
They're on the board. The Tampa Bay lead is 3-1.
Now, this was the type of forecheck we saw in the first 5 minutes of the game. Goddard starts it by getting the puck in. There was no icing because the puck deflected. Goddard's over on this side. He deflects it in off the stick. No icing because it hit the stick. And then very quickly, you saw Asham go in on the forecheck, then helped by Goddard, and Asham just takes it straight to the net. I think Asham's going to get credit for it. But he was quick on the puck. There's the help from Goddard. Stuffs it once, goes at it a second time, and I think it's Asham that gets credit for it. Great forechecking, and the Islanders within a couple goals with 5.5 to go.
Now, with that little time remaining in the third, you would expect the Islanders will take some more chances. Ryan Pressure, Nikolai Habibulin down by 2. Kenny Janssen slaps it away. Wait for the official announcement. Appeared to have been Asham with Goddard in there banging away too.
Yeah, good shift by that line. Asham was put on that line for this third period. They've been pretty good.
It is Aaron Asham, credited with his third goal of the year. Eric Goddard picks up his first point of the year, drawing an assist. And we're down to 5 minutes remaining. The only assist, in fact.
The left pad of Habibulin. And into the net. And Eric Goddard with an assist on the play. Made a good play to create that goal.
For Ninema. Tried to feed it back towards the point to Janssen, but here's Clymer. Janssen the only man back. 3 lightning attack. Clymer's drive. Save DiPietro. And then Svitov gives it up to Janssen. Islanders are going to look to get DiPietro to the bench. He heads out. Now the net's empty. Extra skater for the Islanders, but we've got to get back on side here with 1.5 minutes to go. And a loose puck taken by Pekka. He skates it in. They put up a wall. Hamerlin joins the play. Throws it in front. Cherkovsky batting away. He scores! Marius Cherkovsky! And now it's 3-2 with 1:24 to go in the third. And if you want to rewind to the third Tampa Bay goal,
I do.
That replay we showed you with LeCavalier slipping it back over the line.
Yeah.
Now that looms huge.
Sure does. And Hamerlick took the puck in deep, and he just throws it at the net, and the Islanders attack the net. Parrish was there, and then Cherkovsky able to get the rebound. And Habibulin looks down and says, where'd that one go? Went through the pads. Here's the play by Hamerlick. Parrish deflects it. Cherkovsky gets the rebound and puts it in underneath the...
And now we ask the team captains to come to center ice. Keith Primo of the Flyers and Michael Pekka from the Islanders. Fans, last season, the NHL's seventh man contest recognized the most dedicated fan in the NHL, Islanders fan Roger Farina. To drop the puck in this evening's ceremonial faceoff, he's just back from serving our nation in Iraq. Islanders fans, Please welcome U.S. Army Helicopter Pilot Chief Warrant Officer number 3, Roger Farina.
Roger Farina's going to work the entire Islander bench right now, and good for him.
Because
you want to know how passionate he is. He communicates with a bunch of other Islander fans via the internet. They make and send him tapes of games, as well as other things, just to keep him sane while he's over in Iraq. And this is a guy who's not only fighting for this country, but is as passionate about the Islanders as he is about the United States.
You need more inspiration than that to get you going?
What a moment for Roger Farina, Chief Warrant Officer from the U.S. Army and the NHL's 7th Man of the Year. He was the Islanders' entrant in the contest. He was commissioner for a day, and he dropped a ceremonial puck before this game tonight. Shaking hands with Michael Peck and Keith Primo, and then he got a chance to shake hands with each and every one of the New York Islanders on the bench tonight, our Mohegan Sun moment, and we welcome in one of the biggest Islander fans ever, Roger Farina. Grew up, a couple of miles here from East Meadow. How did you get to be such a big Islander fan?
It started off when I was a kid, 10 years old. My cousin Larry Wolf, he was living in Wisconsin, he came to college at Nassau Community, and him and all his friends would gather at my grandmother's house, who lived around the block from us. And I mean, they're much older than me. They were like 8 years, and they let me, this little kid, hang out with them, and that's how it all started.
Who's your favorite Islander?
Bobby Nystrom, no doubt.
All right, now the deal is that you have a couple of kids whose middle names are
correct. Abigail Nystrom and Allison Gillies.
And
we have one more on the way.
And what is the name? What is the winning choice going to be?
I'm tending towards Potvin, because Dennis Potvin, of course, and because John Potvin came and joined me for dinner while I was commissioner at Club 21 in New York City.
All right, so obviously being overseas, the Islanders get you through some long nights. We're able to listen to them over the internet. Yeah. Tell us about that.
One of the biggest moments I had was right after 9/11. We got deployed to Poland, and it was just a miserable time because nobody knew what was going on. It was scary, and we were in Poland, and that's when the Islanders went on that great, great, unbeaten 11-game streak. Remember that? So, and it was a great distraction, you know?
Right.
It kept your mind off of things.
Have you recruited some of your fellow officers?
Oh, absolutely.
And guys,
it's 2 o'clock in the morning,
through?
And I'm listening. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, and I'm like, get off the computer. The Islander game's on. And they're like, I got in trouble because I'm wearing my jersey and stuff like that. And inside the headquarters talk, Ted.
Well, show us inside your hat. Can you see that?
Is that?
And when did you sew that in?
Yeah, I sewed that in. A little Kuwaiti guy in Kuwait sewed it in before the war for me when we got there.
All right, and one last thing before we go. What are all these?
These are 16 flags.
Neutral zone by the Flyers. Here comes Bergenheim, who makes a move and then just tries to get to the front of the net. And Brashear ends up taking down Mapletoff as he went back. So the Islanders right back on the power play.
A lot of coaches' hats in the stands, too.
Yeah.
I think Pietro gets into the corner.
And on the couches.
From the draw, point a drive, but it hit a leg and didn't get through. So the Islanders again trying to get the power play going. O'Coin, Kanetova, he scores! At long last, a power play goal! And the Islanders lead it 1-0.
Finally! And this is nothing but hard work. One shot, the little pass, and Ninema takes a shot right off the pass and puts it past Hackett, and look at the players in front. Blake directly in front of the goaltender Hackett. I don't think Hackett got a clear view of the puck. That's what they've wanted this team to do. Go hard to the net, cause some traffic in front, make it difficult on the goaltender, and then shoot the puck on the net. Seemed pretty simple, didn't it?
Well, it does when it works, and it's step one towards relaxing.
Fend off one man. Nice little pass. Second nice pass. Hard shot with Blake as a screen. And the Islanders a power play goal and a 1-0 lead.
Yanni Ninema, former Philadelphia Flyer, drilling that one past Jeff Hackett at 13:59. And you mentioned last night in Detroit that the Islanders had gone 4 games in a row without doing something that they've done now tonight, scoring a goal in the first 2 periods.
Yeah.